Hello, beautiful people. Welcome to a very special DSP video. We're back. DSP started his HateLive, so I figured, you know what? I might as well do another DSP video while we're at this. We need to watch the entire thing from start to finish. This is the first time I'm watching this, so we're going to both go in blind, or at least I'll be going in blind, and talking about it. So, there you go. Without further ado, let's start. Let's start this thing, as they say.
All right, hello and good evening, everyone.
Hello.
Wow. This feels a little weird, because it's been over a month, if you can believe it, since I did a podcast last. Yeah, it's been over a freaking month since the last HateLive. It was actually August 13th, and today is September 18th, 2015. What a month it's been, let me tell you. And we're going to go over everything.
What a month. I agree.
What's been going on with me and what I've been through and all the stuff happening. Now we're in the hardcore gaming season, the busiest gaming time of the year, and I'm pretty much slammed with new release after new release and getting through some of these incredibly long and lengthy releases and having a lot of fun. I am having a ton of fun. Every day I'm sitting down and playing games that I'm having
ton of fun
playing, and that's great. Because sometimes you get stuck in a game that maybe is like a long grind.
Again, camera here.
Disappointing, but you've
already put over here.
Time into it that you want.
So that's why I'm looking this way.
It, right? But that's not the case. In this case, the games I've been playing have been pretty entertaining. I've been liking them. And I'm having a lot of fun so far.
Let me ask stream chat.
With everything that I've been doing. So, here we are. It's a month later. First of all, why hasn't there been a HateLive in a month? It's very simple. It's because I was sick. I was busy with new releases.
He was sick. Okay, this is something I want to kind of call him out because weirdness here. This is kind of weird timing on my part. I was also sick a few weeks ago. I had a strep throat, basically. So, you know, it was very sore in my throat. It would hurt. You know, every time I would talk, every time I would swallow, whatever. It was sore, whatever. If I had to do a video, let's say that YouTube is my career, and I had to do a video, and I had that strep throat going on, I probably would have put something together. I probably would have done, you know, something. I would probably would have just recorded me doing a drawing or an art or art piece, whatever. I would have put something up. He has it a little bit easier because he just plays video games. He could have played a video game. He wouldn't have to talk and just play the game. You could say that that's boring, but it's something, and, you know, if you're his fan, you would probably like it regardless, because, you know, you like watching his content, etc. I mean, it's not a big deal, whatever, but he had a cold, and I listened to a few of his videos while he was having this cold, and he sounded normal, he sounded fine, he didn't sound, you know, disgusting. I mean, he sounded the same as he did in the other videos, he just snorted louder, that's all. He could have just kept going, because the cold, here's the thing with the cold, it is like the weakest sickness you could get. I had a cold before. Yeah, it's a nuisance, it's annoying, it sucks, but it's like not the worst sickness you could get. So I think he totally over-dramatized, exaggerated the condition he was in, because he was just, you know, whatever. He could have done a video. He could have done anything. I mean, he didn't have to be like, oh, well, I'm cold. I can't do anything. And I don't know. That's just me. I think a cold is like a nothing disease. I mean, a cold isn't something that you have to, like, that cripples you or something. Or something that, you know, oh, I mean, I have a cold now. I can't, you know, do the stuff I usually do. It's not that big of a sickness. I mean, come on. Come on, Phil.
Finally, this was the first chance that I had to sit down and do a podcast. In addition, for several weeks, I couldn't even live stream. And
oh, man. You know, podcast, funny that a lot of people
live streaming it.
A lot of people liked him more when he didn't live stream, but he's still live streaming now.
If you want to watch it live, you can watch it live, or you can watch it on demand on YouTube, depending on your schedule.
But the thing is, you're a different person when you stream. Like, right here, you see why he's
doing the podcast.
Here's the thing. The reason why people liked him playing without streaming is that he didn't have the stream chat, so he had to, like, play the game genuinely, and that's what people liked. Now, since he has the stream chat enabled and he can stream again, it's like, I'm gonna play a game. Oh, now look at the stream chat. Oh, okay, I have to go. Like, that's not fun. That's why people, you know, that's why a lot of people kind of didn't like him streaming, was because he looked at the chat all the time. That's why people liked him when he wasn't streaming, because he didn't have the chat holding his hand, but whatever, whatever, Phil.
And it sucked that I had to deal with false copyright strikes and all kinds of legal false issues and shit for some weeks there. But it did all get cleared up, and
the thing is that, okay, the thing is with this, actually, no, I talked about this already, never mind, I'm not going to repeat myself. Watch my other video.
Major segment tonight. I've got notes and everything here.
He said he would never talk about the copyright strikes again. He's talking about the copyright strikes in this podcast. Okay, Phil, you're right. Expose YouTube.
Segment tonight is going to be my discussion of what I've gone through over the years, way back in 2010 when I first had copyright strikes on YouTube accounts, and right now the stuff that I just went through not even a month ago, how I dealt with it. Now I've actually sought legal counsel. Yes,
so many YouTubers deal with it. I'm sorry. It sucks.
I know actually exactly,
but it's not like, you know,
works. I got it from the horse's mouth. I spoke with the higher ups at Machinima and the legal counselors who explained to me how YouTube's copyright system works, and I'm going to reveal all this tonight.
Man, I have a feeling he didn't talk to anyone, I don't know.
People keep this shit, like, behind closed doors, and there's been so many people, like, YouTubers, big YouTubers, alright, who don't seem to understand how YouTube's copyright system actually works.
But he doesn't watch all the YouTubers, though.
Even in videos, you know, YouTubers that are much bigger than me say all these incorrect statements about YouTube copyright law, about how YouTube's copyright system works, and there was actually a big development, a new case, a court case, that was determined this past week that everyone's speculating may affect YouTube. We're going to talk about all that tonight. In addition, tonight, we've got tons and tons of gaming news. We've had about a dozen stories.
Dozen stories.
This past week, whether it's DLC releases, whether it's new games coming out, whether it's games being delayed, whether it's...
I can't wait to listen to this. I can't wait.
...directional shifts of gaming development companies. We've got a ridiculous amount of gaming news to talk about for you tonight. And, it's going to be good. It's going to be a great amount of discussion and information for everyone. As usual, I'm going to review my schedule. I'm going to talk to you about all the stuff that I'm playing recently and what I think about it, etc. So stay tuned for a pretty packed show.
All right. Pretty packed. Look at that chat.
How long the show will be tonight. There's no back-in-the-day segment or anything like that, because I really do feel that with all the stuff I have here, it's going to be enough to cover the entire show.
Did you do a back-in-the-day segment in the other HateLives? I feel like he hasn't done one in a long time, but whatever, I haven't seen a lot of these. I've only seen maybe like two.
Soaking wet here. Keep in mind, this is a live show, so I will take a break at some point.
Thanks for reminding me, Phil.
If you're watching this live on stream, please just be patient, okay, during that portion of the show. I'll be back within a few minutes. If you're watching this on YouTube,
he's the only one that just feel like they just breaks, which is ridiculous.
So you'll be able to jump ahead.
Especially on YouTube, I've not seen YouTube streamers do that.
Right now, if you're like, I don't want to hear this intro segment, I want to hear a specific segment, you can check the description of the video right now, and you can jump ahead to the portion of the show that you want to watch.
Okay? Once it's uploaded, now I can't do that.
If you like the show, consider giving it a thumbs up, whether you're watching on demand or you're watching the live.
I'll give you a thumb, something alright.
This show, boom. I do it as often as I can.
Dislike.
I don't get to do Hate Live as often as I would like. I'll be honest.
The reason why I dislike this video is because he said he doesn't ask for likes. And he does ask for a like in a very sneaky way. He said, if you like this video, hit the like button. It doesn't sound like he's begging for likes, but that's what he's doing.
I wish I could do it weekly. But with all the stuff going on, with all the games releasing and everything, I have not had that opportunity in the 2 years.
It's not a big deal, though, to be honest. I just dislike this video because there's a lot of nonsense, probably. I already know you just see nonsense.
Like, more so than ever before, people are tuning into Hate Live. And I don't know if it's just that I don't do it as often as I'd like, or maybe people just like to hear my opinions on stuff. I don't know, but...
What about the haters?
The viewership's up. It means I'm doing something right. I'm happy if you're happy. I'm happy that I'm doing the show.
He has 404 viewers, so that's something. Right? That's
so
something.
Thank you for that, and let's get started. Oh, by the way, one final thing. If you just watched the last episode of Hate Live, right, and now you're watching this, you're like,
Something's different.
Yes, my beard.
Something's different. Something's different. I shaved.
And this is hilarious, so I'm going to bring it up.
See that? See, didn't you care about that? Didn't you care that I told you that I shaved?
About my beard, saying, my God, it looks like Phil's beard is shrinking. It looks like, what's wrong with his beard? Does his beard have balding or something? Is he not able to grow his
beard? This is the second time he's talking about his beard.
I had a big beard, right? Originally, I actually at one point had a beard all the way growing down, connecting to my goatee
beard. Who cares about your beard?
And I just had the
that's like me saying, like, guys, I got a haircut. I got a haircut here, man. Like, it used to be long. And, you know, people thought I was weird, so I cut it. And that's why I look like this.
What I would do is I would
they didn't screw up my hair, so I was happy. I was happy about that. And then I shaved today.
Because I was like,
man, I don't like how much hair is on my face, so I shaved it.
And even when I just, originally when I just moved here.
So please put in the comment section how much you care about me shaving my face and my haircut. Please let me know, because obviously if you're watching this video, you want to know about my face, my hair situation.
And I was screwing up the shaving. And incidentally, I really wasn't like sick or anything. I wasn't in a situation where I wasn't putting out content and filming myself for an extended period of time for the whole past year. And then all of a sudden, as you guys know, in late August, I got pretty sick. I got a really bad sore throat, and I was congested. I didn't record myself talking for like over a week. And because of that, I didn't shave. I didn't
do anything. Son, don't talk to me about sore throats.
During that week that I was really
I'm not gonna argue about that. This isn't gonna be a pissing competition about sickness.
I was able to regrow the goatee. So the goatee
but who cares about your goatee? I don't give a shit about your beard.
There's been so many things going on.
I know why he's talking about his beard, because he probably sees a lot of haters making fun of his beard, because I have seen on Twitter people say like, oh, look at his beard, it looks like shit. I don't give a shit about his beard. It could look like a whatever beard. I don't give a shit. He shouldn't have talked about it. He shouldn't talk about it, you know, but he's talking about it because the haters were talking about it. I have a feeling that's what it is, but whatever, that's just a theory. That's just a theory, guys. It's not fact.
At least the 100th episode, the big anniversary episode of DSP Tries It, which is my ongoing product testing series where I will
mostly test
fast food, but there's other things along the
line. Fast food? He does mostly fast food on it.
And it was a super long episode. It was two different things that I had tried. It was actually two separate episodes that I combined into one for a special anniversary episode. Plus, I did like an intro. And it's funny because if you watch the intro, my goatee is one length. If you watch the first half of the video, my goatee's a different length, and then for the third part, it shrinks.
Wow, I thought he was talking about his DSP Tries It video, but instead he's talking about his beard. It's like, okay guys, I did my 100th episode video, and you might have noticed, I had a beard. Can you believe that? I had a beard in that video, and then I shaved it, like, come on.
Alright, it's not. This is all fully grown in, but
he knows his demographic, and they care about his beard, apparently.
I get a few in my head, but mostly in my beard. I got them, like, all right here. It's all white hairs right here.
All right here. Look at this. Look at this beard.
You look over here. Oh, it looks patchy. It's not patchy. It's just the hairs are white. They're not dark. So I know that's a really stupid, superfluous segment there, but I got questions on it for over a year, and I said that's
who questioned
to address it, all right?
Who was asking about your beard? I want to know who. Give me names.
This week's episode, which launches tomorrow, right here on the King of Hate Live, is an episode. There's something that people have left a comment on my ESP
videos
for
over
a year. In fact, I'd say probably for 2 or 3 years, people have been leaving this one particular comment or suggestion or question on my DSP Tries It videos. So this week, I said, I'm going to do and try what people have been saying for years they want to see me try. And I did. I tried it.
I don't know what he tried.
I got fucking food poisoning. Yeah, I got food poisoning from what I ate, because I knew for years it's a bad idea to try this, but people kept saying to try it, and I said, all right, I'll do it, and I got food poisoning. I woke up yesterday morning on my...
I'm not a doctor. I never had food poisoning, but I've heard stories of people who had food poisoning, so whatever. He took one day off from streaming. He canceled HateLive and for one day because he had food poisoning. I'm pretty sure if you had food poisoning, it wouldn't last a day. It's a crazy hunch, but I don't think it would last one day. Because he was streaming before that. He was streaming on Tuesday, Monday, all this stuff. Thursday. He's like, oh, I have food poisoning. I can't do it. And it's like, and now he's fine. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, he skipped out on work for fishy reasons. I just think, I'm just calling his BS. He might have felt like shit. You know, he might have had, like, an upset stomach, but I don't think it was food poisoning, because I feel like you would still feel it today. Like, I don't know. Call me crazy. I just don't think food poisoning would last one day and then never come back again.
Stomach. Oh, my God. I felt like someone had a drill and they were drilling into my stomach. It felt like literally like it was a bottomless pit, but it felt so sickening. There was no way that I could eat anything. And I stood up out of bed and my head was spinning. I was
moving. I was in the bathroom. I was like, I don't know why that made me laugh. Today, I was really like...
I finally felt better. So yesterday I didn't even live stream, and that's why we're actually doing Hate Live tonight instead of Thursday like usually I would. Because I was so sick from getting
food poisoning. He was so sick. He had food poisoning.
I hope it was worth it. I hope you'll check out DSP Tries It tomorrow.
You know, I'm going to do a video on that. Thank you, Phil. You gave me an idea for a video. I'm going to watch it. I'm going to watch it tomorrow.
I went through it, and you'll see tomorrow exactly what it was.
Take a sip.
Okay. So, moving on. Let's get this out of the way. Before we start talking about what I've been up to and my gaming schedule, because I'm going to update everyone.
I'll get all of this.
I've had a lot of questions about...
This is a little off-topic, but, I got inspired by watching Tevin. So if you want to watch better videos, go to Tevin's channel.
Decide yet if I was going to play
the same.
I kind of have now. We're going to get to that, but let's get this out of the way, ladies and gentlemen.
But I hope you like this video, too, but...
As you know, this year I adopted Patreon. It's been a very, very successful year. I have nothing but positive things to say about
Patreon. Little free plug for him, but...
Besides the fact that I've gotten new equipment that makes me...
I feel like I should say something about it.
The fact that I've got... You know, soundproofing, the fact that I have an air conditioner, I can sit here comfortably.
Should be soundproofing AC, but he didn't make it as a goal. He just
has improved. The fact that I've got a green screen set up now to mess around with. All these massive improvements, right? And they're all due to Patreon. They really are.
Thank you, you fucking worthless humans. For the dollar.
My content has kind of gone up a notch this year.
All
right.
Dollar's all he needs.
It's been very successful. I just want to let everyone know that on patreon.com/darksidephil. The new goals.
In case you didn't see the plug on the bottom right corner, in case you didn't see that, he had to say it.
My top goal for the month, which is
$1,200. That's why for his blind viewers.
By the way, is my normal top goal of funding. It's no different than anything. We're going to do a Halloween horror games marathon.
Everyone guessed this, and you're right.
Like my typical mini marathon, where the stream will run between 6 and 7 hours long, and we'll have lots of different content on there.
Okay. See, he said 6 to 7 hours long. Before, again, go to watch one of Tevin's videos, because he kind of goes into more details on this, but he said 7 hours gameplay stream, whatever. He said something definitive in a video in the past. He said something definitive like that. He promised it, and now he's saying 6 to 7 hours. You know what? I don't really care about that, but I'm going to let the other, YouTube channels, other haters, time it and all that stuff. I'm not going to watch that, but I have better stuff to do than watch him play games. But, again, like the Crash Bandicoot stream, as a lot of fans on Twitter have been saying, has been less than 6 hours, so I wouldn't be surprised if this is the same thing.
Might be only one game. If people want to see me only play one particular game,
but this is be free. Now he's taking money for it.
A little bit of each one. It all depends on what the patrons choose. So if you're a
patron, power to the patrons.
September, which you have a little bit less.
DSP is the new GameStop.
At patreon.com/darksidephil, you're gonna get to nominate and then vote on the games you want to see me play during this horror marathon.
And then he shits on people who
I've never done a horror marathon for Halloween.
Then he shits on people who. Suggest like Five Nights at Freddy's. I really hope people suggest Five Nights at Freddy's for him, because,
I've had so many new releases that typically come out in October. In fact, in just to name a few, the end of October, we've got Assassin's Creed Syndicate, Halo 5, and WWE 2K16 all releasing within a week.
Oh,
so
man.
I have more than enough stuff to be doing, but I decided this year, if the patrons, if we hit that goal, and if the patrons really want it, we're going to do a Halloween marathon on Halloween. I think that'll be pretty cool. And maybe I'll even dress up. We'll see. You know, maybe we'll still do face cam and we'll dress up.
Oh, just like Angry Joe. Angry Joe did does dress up too.
I do on Halloween, all right? So if we hit that goal, we'll do it.
Phil's adapting.
So check it out, patreon.com/darksidephil. And yes, I will be bringing this up more as we get towards the end of the month.
He has three plugs. Shits on Kojima for plugging himself and his game.
Some people are actually
plugs himself all the time.
This episode of Hate Live.
How many times does he have to show his script? It's like, look at this script.
Happening on October 1st, 2015. I want to call that out. October 1st, 2015 will be the next episode of Ask the King, FYI. All right.
Oh, yeah, now, he didn't right do Ask the King for almost a month.
Also, you can get t-shirts, you can get private Q&A videos. I actually just filmed and uploaded a private Q&A video for someone yesterday. And I am planning on doing specials for both Thanksgiving, and that special is going to be more multiplayer-focused with viewers.
Multiplayer?
More of like a holiday, traditional holiday special like I usually
do. Oh, it is like, oh, we have special guests with the fans. I wouldn't say, like, multiplayer. It's multiplayer.
Part of a holiday special.
So I feel like the holiday special is going to be him playing a video game with fans. I bet you that's what it is.
Okay.
I bet that's what it is. It's not going to be a film thing. It's going to be him playing games with fans.
Let's talk about what's happened to me this past
week. Yes.
Since I've done an episode of Hate Live.
Yes, right? let's talk about the copyright tricks again. Third time. This is the third time he's talking about it.
Some things fell through that I didn't want to fall through, but let's get the elephant out of the room. Ladies and gentlemen, I did not come through with Project 7. And I already did a whole video explaining it. I'm not going to go...
What is this? What?
Everyone who's angry about it and upset already vented.
What?
We already got it out of the way. We're already into the hardcore gaming season. But, you know, I have to admit, that was one of my biggest failures this year, was that I was really hoping and planning that during the summer I was going to find a way to manage my schedule and make time to work and reboot Project 7 as a series, and I didn't do it. And rather,
but I got your money. Thank you, though.
Rather than try to do something that wasn't going to be good...
I'm sorry I didn't do it, but I took your money, and then I put it in stuff you didn't pay for, but I'm sorry I didn't do it. It was a disappointment. Feel sorry for me. Don't you feel the emotion in my voice? Don't you think I'm really sad? I'm very disheartened that I didn't do Project 7. Oh my god, I'm very disappointed. Please, please, understand. It's a hardcore gaming season. Did that sound genuine to you? Okay. Please comment below if you think that was genuine. If you think what he just said was genuine.
I decided to just say, forget it. Let's just
forget it. Games, let's talk about games.
Right now from me, and let's put a major focus on that. And that's what I did for the rest of the summer.
You might have paid me $12.50, but let's focus on games. Something that you didn't pay me to do.
I played the shit out of Fallout New Vegas to the point where now I'm almost at the end of it, which is great.
Sorry, I mean, this is you shouldn't be talking about Project 7 at this point, because people are already salty. This is just kind of like twisting the knife in the wound.
I think I made the right decision. Ultimately, as a creator,
he made
have to take over.
No. Don't call yourself a creator, Phil. You're not a creator, because no one would... I mean, again, like, look. I'll show you something. See, I was working on something when I was, you know, away. This is more work than Phil. This is a little self-plug right here. See this? This is a storyboard. This is what they call in the art business. That this is a storyboard. Look at this effort. This whole sketchbook is full of storyboards that I'm working on right now. That's more work than Phil did put in Project 7. And that took me, like, one page would take me, like, maybe 30 minutes, because I do little quick sketches so I know what things look like. I did some model sheets. And then I did another, like, quick, you know, a little bit of a refined storyboard right here. See, I already have two storyboards here. He had nothing for Project 7, and he's calling himself a creator. He said that it was the right move to... No, you know what? I talked about this. I'm not talking about it again.
Ultimately, all right?
This really pisses me off. I'm sorry. It really does piss me off, because I can't imagine people doing this.
I took that
it's like Mega 64 promising version 4, then not delivering version 4.
For September, which means that yes, this month, at the end of this month, or early October, I still haven't set the date in stone yet, there's going to be a mini marathon of indie games. And in fact, right now, the Patreon...
I can't wait to see him play Hotline Miami. I really hope he plays Hotline Miami again.
August, excuse me. The patrons from the month of August are nominating on indie games for me to play in this mini marathon, and then this next week they're going to be voting on what games are actually going to make it to that marathon.
Please, so, Hotline Miami. I want to see him play that game again. I don't want to pay him to play it.
I can't give the money back because it wasn't like anyone specifically pledged and said, I want Project 7, because that's not how Patreon works. You can't just pledge towards, this is what
but
I want.
But you could,
that's not how it works when it comes to.
Again, isn't there a way?
I thought was the best thing. I couldn't refund the money. There's no way for $200 or $250 or however much that was raised towards Project 7, there's no way that I could
There's nothing I could do. I mean, it's not like I could actually deliver on Project 7 or anything. It's not like I can, you know, work on a script and show the script and say that's Project 7. No, no, you couldn't do that. Or you couldn't at least wait to get something solid concrete done, then have... God damn, Phil. God damn, I'll do the work for you. How about that? I'll handle Project 7 for you. I'll probably get something done. Ugh. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do his work for him, actually.
I got a decent amount of money towards buying a new camera. I've raised around $350 at this point as of right now.
Right now.
A new camera, and I've been saying my ultimate goal is around $750 to get a really nice camera. It definitely has to be
You don't
a
need
I like a 4K camera, but I don't know if I would find a
You don't need Like I did a video with this, an iPod. I did a video with this, by the way. It's gonna come out. You're gonna see it and tell me how good the quality is. I know this does 1080p and 30 frames, but I know it's not gonna be as good as a camcorder or like a camera. It's a fucking iPod. This is better than my flip, to be honest. I had a flip that I did videos on, and now I got this, and I actually like using this more.
You know, it sucks that I couldn't do projects.
You know, it's all like, oh man, this isn't a good camera. I'm not gonna do videos. Like, no, come on.
One thing that unfortunately didn't get finished was my Godfather cooperative playthrough that I've been playing with Leanna, and that one unfortunately has been on hold now for several weeks because we thought we were gonna be able to beat the game within a 3-hour time frame. We played it for 6 hours one day, finding out that the last mission of the game is like 6 hours long. It's insane.
Wait, so they played 6 hours.
We just played the shit out of it and could not beat it in time before the new releases came out. Until Dawn literally released that same day that we were playing The Godfather.
Until Dawn is like the most mixed game I've heard. I've heard like good and bad things from all sides. I know people other than Phil who like that game. It's not original. I'm sorry, but it's the same stuff you've seen with like The Walking Dead, Heavy Rain.
Probably one of my most fun playthroughs to do in quite some time because I had at that time I've been hit with false copyright strikes.
Whoa.
And we're gonna get into that. I'm not going to go into detail about that now because we're going to talk about that later on in the show. But because I've been hit
You talked about two times.
I couldn't live stream. So I actually had to do this playthrough offline, no stream chat.
But as he's like on stream chat.
Old school offline recording the videos and then uploading them to YouTube. And people loved it. They said the commentary was
great. People loved it. But I'm never going to do it again.
During the playthrough. And I liked the game so much that even though I got a terrible sore throat, I toughed through it and I finished the game by
Oh, what a poor baby.
When I came back from 3 days off from having this insanely bad sore throat, even with terrible
And I listened to the videos on YouTube, and he sounded so sick. Dude, I don't know how he does it. I don't know. I don't know how he does it. Like, he just sounded, his voice was like this, and he just snorted it some more. What a brave person Phil is to do this for us.
Playthrough.
I'm being sarcastic, by the way. I don't.
So it ended up being, in my opinion, one of my favorite video series in a long time. Well, definitely one of my favorite playthrough games for a long time. And I hope that if you haven't, you checked it out. The video views were insane, like really well, like everyone.
Yeah, because people liked that you didn't stream it because every person I've seen that complained that it was a fan of his said that you know he doesn't like that stream. Look at stream chat. You know, he would look at stream chat, and he would get his handheld. A lot of people complain about that, and he still does it.
I got sick, and I couldn't review the game for several weeks. In fact, I did just review Until Dawn.
I watched a little bit of it, and it was kind of whatever on it. It was kind of whatever on that review. I was thinking of doing a video on it, but...
At this point, it has like 7,000 or 8,000 views, which is great, but I get the feeling if I had reviewed the game a lot earlier, more people would have cared. It's just I didn't get a chance to review it because I was so sick. And then I ended up being so busy with other games, I didn't get a chance to do it. So, the review is live for those who've been waiting for it.
I had a Kill a Kill review I was planning on uploading, a while ago. Then,
so after Until Dawn, of course, we jumped
the program did not save my progress, and now I have to redo that video, that recording. Whoopee, right?
The same exact day, which usually is the kiss of death And in this case, it was the kiss of death for Mad Max. I hate to say it. Mad Max.
That I kind of agree with. I had a feeling.
Mad Max is an interesting game.
You know, Mad Max had kind of balls to come out the same day, but.
Side missions, including races, but also hand-to-hand combat, a la Batman
Knight,
or other games of that sort, where you have the time to button presses.
I heard, like, mixed things about that game, too. I mean, it's... I'm waiting for a price drop. I like Mad Max, but, I don't know. I didn't like the fact that you had to build a car in Mad Max, and that was the focus. I didn't like that. I don't care about cars, okay? So, that's what kind of sold me away from it.
It's got a ton of
stuff. Looks at stream chat, looking 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 at stream... Okay, alright.
The problem is, Mad Max number 1 was released way too long after the movie. If this game had been released at the same time as Mad Max Fury Road, I think tons of people would have bought it. But you released the game like some 4 to 6 months after the movie comes out, people already forgot about the movie.
I didn't forget about the movie. A lot of people still talk about the movie. I still see fan art of the movie.
The same exact day as the one of the biggest game releases of the year, you are going to not get the wide mainstream market. And that's exactly what happened here. Everyone who was going to buy a game in early September...
But even then, like...
And skipped Mad Max. And because of that, I really feel this game is not getting its due. Now, don't get me wrong. Is Mad Max game of the year? No, I don't think so. In fact, I can tell you right now, definitively...
Look at where you keep pause for that, but whatever.
But it's a good game. This is a game that I feel if Mad Max...
I don't think it was that good. I don't know. I don't know. I can't say I haven't played it, so...
Contender. The problem is this year we've had so many games that have open world concepts, so many games that have tons and tons of content within them, that it's hard to say, oh, Mad Max, when you see, oh, well, there's a game that did it slightly better or did it, you know...
I like how the soundproofing phone, but you still hear stuff going on in the background. I'm not sure you could pick up on it, because the way I'm recording this, but... I'm hearing, like, background noise in this. It has soundproofing foam.
And I am not getting, I kid you not even probably one quarter of the amount of people, 25% of the amount of people who are watching...
But he doesn't care about views, right?
...are watching Mad Max. They're just like, forget it. Metal Gear Solid 5, yes, Mad Max, fuck that game. And I can't even get, like, 1,000 views.
Maybe they didn't want to watch Mad Max because they don't really care. They want to see Metal Gear Solid 5 because it's kind of what, you know, people are more curious about because it's Kojima's last game. Mad Max will always be there. And the other thing with Mad Max is that maybe they don't like how he's playing it. There's all kinds of factors as to why people may not watch that video. But he also complained about Metal Gear Solid 5 views for a while as well. I remember that. But then it switched to Mad Max not getting enough views. But I don't think it's because of the game. It might be because of the commentator, but it could be both. It could be both. I'll meet halfway with people. It could be both.
On a video for Mad Max anymore.
But he shouldn't care about views. That is something that we all agree with. He shouldn't care about views.
Like an old school playthrough that I were doing, right? Oh, he's doing a throwback game. Well, you know, it's a downtime game. Not a lot of people usually check those out. This is a new release. And after that first maybe 2 or 3 sessions, people turned completely off and said, screw this. It's not the hyped game, and we're not going to tune in anymore.
It's not the hyped game. I don't know. People are hyped for Mad Max.
A game that's way more fun to play than to watch. If that's the case, I can't answer that question because I'm not watching. I'm playing. You know what I mean? So I can't actually answer that. But I do think it's very unfortunate that it's not
getting any
chat. Even when you look at reviews, everyone is still right now, as of today, talking about Metal Gear Solid 5, right? Every review, everyone's still, Metal Gear Solid 5, Metal Gear Solid 5, Metal Gear Solid 5. After the release night, who talked about Mad Max again, right?
Because Metal Gear Solid 5 has a legacy. Okay, look. Metal Gear Solid 5 has a legacy. The Metal Gear series has a legacy. It's been around for 25 plus years. It's almost being 30 years. They have people know it. Mad Max didn't have a video game for years. This is the first, as far as I know, this is the first Mad Max game that they've made. Of course people are going to talk about Metal Gear because they know that game. They know that. And you know, with the whole thing with Konami Kojima kind of added to the interest. So of course that's why people care more about Metal Gear, because it's an interesting game than Mad Max, but whatever.
Sleeper hit of the year. This will be the game that you don't hear sleeper about. Sleeper hit, yeah. And all of a sudden 6 months from now, it's $10 on
it. It could be a sleeper hit.
Everyone buys it, loves it. But you didn't play it at release, right? And that's
because that matters. Like, that matters. I had to play.
Playing it, but I said this. I said, listen, I'm a gamer, but at this point, I'm also a businessman. I'm operating a business that needs
businessman.
To make a certain amount of money so I can pay my bills, right?
If he was a businessman, he would have delivered Product 7. That
invest a ridiculous amount of time, or at least the main amount of time that I gain, playing a game that no one's watching. So I said, I will continue with Mad Max.
It's going to be a long video. I can already tell. So, enjoy this long video, guys.
Without finishing the game, but it's going to be the back burner playthrough, meaning Mad Max is going to be that game that I'm kind of playing on second stream all month, only a couple hours a day when I do play it, and it's going to be dragged out, and you're not going to
see it soon. It's gonna probably what is this? Holding his neck together? Like, it's
rather than me trying to get
through. I don't know. That was just a nitpick right there. I'm sorry.
It is what it is. You know what I mean? It is what it is.
It is what it is, you know what I mean? It is what it is.
I'm not complaining, I'm just saying Mad Max, I feel, is a game that is not getting its due. And that's a shame, okay? On the flip side of that, Metal Gear Solid 5, I think is actually a superb game. Absolutely, it should be a Game of the Year contender. But I certainly, with some of the insanely fanboyish things that I've seen mainstream media saying about this game, 10 out of 10. How many media outlets gave this game a 10 out of 10?
If you like Metal Gear Solid 5, and if you gave it a 10 out of 10, congratulations, you're a fanboy. That's Phil's logic right there. Look, I like Metal Gear. I can kind of see 10 out of 10 to me. I kind of would give it a 9. Honestly, that's my review of it so far. I would give it a 9. I beat the game last night, and I would definitely give it a 9 out of 10. I think it was great. I definitely see why people say that, you know, it might be incomplete. But just because there's cut content, that doesn't mean that it's incomplete. It might have been cut for reasons that we don't know. I mean, it could have been because of Rushed, or it could be because maybe that scene didn't really fit, or, you know, there might have been game bugs with it that, you know, couldn't be fixed. Many reasons could be why it was cut. We don't know. We'll never know. So it could be anything. But still, I could see it being a 10 out of 10. I don't consider cut content to be incomplete. At that point, you could say that any movie with deleted scenes is an incomplete movie.
10. All right. Now compare that with the fact that the game blatantly had bugs, has issues,
bugs.
Has padding, has
wait,
necessary grinding.
What bugs? I only encountered one bug, mind you. It was in the mission where we were trying to follow this guy to find this POW or whatever. That was only one bug in one mission that I've seen. I've never seen the game bug after that. So, I don't know what bugs he's talking about. Padding, I can kind of see, because after you beat Chapter 1, you kind of just have to go through side ops, like Peace Walker, where you just kind of have to go through to do all that. But I had fun with the side ops, so that's why I would probably give it a 9 out of 10, because I enjoyed the side ops. I can understand why people don't enjoy that, and I can see why some people might downscale the game. I wouldn't blame them. But, you know, I wouldn't say, like, oh, that guy gave it a 9 out of 10. Well, there are side ops, and you have to do them, and you have to grind. It's like that's ridiculous. That's,
has things that aren't
some people like that.
Well, has things that it looks.
It like might be redundant, like, but I enjoyed that.
In the market, and Kojima himself, Hideo Kojima himself, if you buy the collector's edition of Metal Gear Solid 5, says on the behind-the-scenes content, this game that you're playing right now is not how I intended it. I actually had
no. I got the collector's edition, and I'll tell you instantly what it says on the back. All for revenge, you know, the stuff that's on the back, whatever. This is in the bonus edition. The stuff that you get a Blu-ray disc with the Phantom episode that wasn't released with the game because it was 30% complete at the time. Now, that could have not made it in the game, as I said before, for many reasons. But to Phil, no, that means that it wasn't the way he intended it to be. No. And, you know, it could have been Konami shenanigans that made that, you know, episode not, you know, in the game. But it might have just been the Kojima thing. You might have just saw that thing and said, no, this doesn't really fit in the game, or this doesn't really work, or, you know, maybe the engine just couldn't render stuff properly. It could have been multiple reasons. It's not that, oh, well, the game is ruined because this one little mission isn't in the game. Oh, God.
A much more in-depth and better second half of the game. There was an awesome final boss fight.
This wasn't
all this stuff that got cut.
This wasn't in the back of the box. What box was he looking at?
Fuck my team. And told us that, you know, we have to hurry up and finish the game and no more money will be attributed
to you. Dude, okay, this guy talks about how people slander him and all this stuff and put words in his mouth. He's putting words in Kojima's mouth, dude. Like, he's doing what he hates his haters doing to him. The king of hypocrites, guys. The king of hypocrisy. It's ridiculous. And just because one mission is cut or an entire chapter is cut, that doesn't mean, oh, well, Konami messed up with it. He might have made that decision himself. There might have been other reasons. We won't know, so we can't say for sure. And Phil is acting like he has all this proof. Where's this proof? Where did Kojima say this? He's not stating shit.
And that was when all that behind-the-scenes nonsense was going on the past year that we heard about Kojima and Konami and how they were leaving, the team was getting laid off or whatever and all that. That's what we heard. That's what happened. They basically said, no, we're not giving you any more money, just finish the game. How can you give the game that the game developer literally said, this game is not complete?
No, they didn't say that.
The answer is, because you're a fanboy. That's the blatant answer.
Oh my god, this is, like, pissing me off right now. I'm sorry, this is only as bad as Project 7 shit, because, like, look, I can understand people being upset that there's content cut in the game. I'm not gonna say that they're wrong, or that they shouldn't be upset, or you know, I blame them for feeling that way, but I could see people giving this game a 10 out of 10 because they might like the gameplay. The gameplay might be, you know, that might sing to them, and honestly, this is actually the only game that I played that, you know, when they announced it, they kept their promise in the final product. Sure, there's content cut, but it doesn't, but they still kept the core gameplay that they promised. They promised an open world experience where you can go to each mission and do your own thing. You can do all of that. So they followed through with that promise. Cutting content doesn't really mean anything because they didn't promise 70 missions, or they didn't promise anything. We didn't know what to expect. We only knew after the fact that there was cut content. That doesn't mean that Kojima promises and didn't deliver. I felt more betrayed with Destiny than I did with Metal Gear Solid 5, and that's how I feel about that. This is dumb, and just because you give it 10 out of 10 doesn't make you a goddamn fanboy. I'm sorry, that's not how it works. I mean, I might have given Angry Joe some shit for giving Witcher 3 a 10 out of 10, but I wouldn't say he's a fanboy.
So you're a fanboy. I'm not saying the game's bad. In fact, I just admitted it's a Game of the Year contender. This game's not perfect, and this game does not deserve a 10 out of 10 from anyone. Anyone who gave this game a 10 out of 10 is a blatant fucking fanboy.
No.
There's no justification
for
a game that has a list of flaws 10 out of 10. It's that simple.
I had the most fun in Metal Gear Solid 5 than any game I own.
I thought it was a slow start.
Slow start, yeah.
4 days, and I was like, I don't get what everyone's kind of fanboying over. And then all of a sudden, it happened. I got past the early grinding stages of the game, and I got to the more unique story missions, and I started...
Every mission is the same. To be honest, I can see why people say that it's redundant. You know, you do the same missions over and over. But... You know, to me, you do the same missions, but to me, they give it a varied kind of pace, and I like that. I like that about the game. I can stomach redundancy sometimes because it wasn't as blatant to me, at least. I didn't feel it was blatant redundancy, but I could see it. But I don't know. When I was playing it, I wasn't thinking about it. But he was doing the same missions later on, and now it's like, oh, now it's great.
Unlocking the better things in the game, like the better buddies and assists, and the better weapons and the
better buddies. Loadouts.
And the game got so much better after that, but it really has this required uphill grind of about 10 to 15 hours of doing repetitive stuff.
But
you reach that peak where you're like, yes, this is awesome.
I'm sorry, this is a long video. I'm like, really,
whatever. And I liked it from then on. I'm sorry. I really liked it from then on. And
against
I
think chat?
It's a great game. I really do think it's a great game. I'm going to reserve my ultimate
judgment. It's a great game. I think it's a great game.
Until I actually beat it. And I'm actually going to talk a little bit later on in the show about Konami.
Oh boy! Oh,
there was a big announcement from Konami more this week that everyone.
Oh, I know what announcement. I'm going to spoil it right here. So, spoiler alert! It's about Konami posting an article. I think, or it's a speculation. It's a rumor article, whatever. It's speculation at this. I think it's speculation, but let's assume it's not. It's Konami saying that they're not interested in doing AAA games anymore. Surprise, surprise! Right? You guys are surprised. Yeah, I'll bet you when I said that you. Price bit out whatever you were drinking, right? Yeah, okay.
I was like, oh my god, we saw this coming, but we'll get to that when we get to the gaming news, alright?
Of course, gaming news. Oh my god.
Alright.
That was the longest drink.
So, what else have I been doing? Well, the only other real things that have been going on is
okay,
I've been
great.
Playing...
I'm glad we're over with Metal Gear. I don't want him to talk about it anymore.
The playthrough, I'm pleased to announce that I am almost at the end of my Fallout New Vegas playthrough at this point. We're actually in the end game, where at the very end of the game, there's one major side quest that I have not been able to trigger yet, and I've been trying really hard. It's the one with Arcade Ganon, where you try to trigger the Remnants of the Enclave side quest. And it's really hard to get it to trigger because Arcade hates the Caesar's Legion, but this playthrough, I sided with the Caesar's Legion.
It's kind of funny. So really, I haven't played Fallout New Vegas at all. I have it, but I haven't played it. So we're still wrapped.
Tiptoeing around this.
So hearing this, I don't know what's going on here.
Ultimately, the next time I play the
it's kind of funny. Like for me, at least. It's funny for me because I haven't played Fallout New Vegas. So hearing this is nonsense. It's like how a parent feels when their kid is like talking about video games and they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. They're like, whoa, okay.
I'm not doing DLCs for Fallout New Vegas. And just so you know, I warned everyone when I started playing the game back in August. I said, you have a choice. Either I'll play the game hardcore mode with
hardcore
melee
mode.
Combat, which I know will be far more difficult, or I'll do the DLCs. And everyone overwhelmingly said, we want to see hardcore mode, you've never done it before, we want to see melee combat, you've never done it before. And
melee.
But I get the feeling that I'm not going to finish this game quickly, you know, it's going to be tough to get through a lot of parts of the game, and so then, you know, just understand, no DLCs, and that's what's happened. This month, here we are, it's the 18th of September. If I play one or two more sessions, you figure just by the end of the month, I should finish up my Fallout New Vegas playthrough. And that'll be perfect because it'll end it on a high note. We'll be ready, we'll be prepared. We'll have 1 month in October away from it, and then we'll get back into it on November 10th, right? November 10th, Fallout 4 is released, and I'm very much looking forward to it. I really am. So, the final thing I want to talk about.
Final okay, thing.
And then we're actually going to go into gaming news, because I have a
ton of boy, gaming news.
The final thing that I want to talk about is
final thing.
Super Mario Maker. Now, for those of you who did not check out any of my streams or footage,
the hate
of
all
Maker,
that,
I'm going to tell you
like
right
that.
Now, you are missing out. If you are a fan of any of the original Super Mario games, this game is superb. This game is fun as all hell. And whether you're a creator and you love to create your own levels, or if you just want to take on really creative and challenging levels that other people have made, this game is your game, all right? It features content from four Super Mario games. Super Mario Brothers
1, 3, okay, fuck, I fucked up. 1, 3,
Super Mario games are in there, with all the different enemies and things and everything in there.
That was kind of funny.
Apparently there's a lot missing, but there's a lot in there to work with as well. And you've got your overworld, underworld, underwater, and there's actually more stuff I haven't unlocked.
Oh, sweet, I didn't know that. I thought it was only overworld.
All these thousands of levels.
Now I can definitely see why it's worth $60. I was feeling that it should be 20 or 30, but now I'm hearing all the stuff in it. I think it is definitely worth 60.
Fucking infuriating because they're so hard, and the only way you could beat them is if you absolutely know the super perfect way to do it, which you wouldn't know unless you made the fucking stage. So,
but I think it's fun though.
Silly stuff. There's Mega Man, Sonic the Hedgehog,
Sonic
Pikachu, Samus. They're all the characters from all these different games.
You fit trainers in it.
There's Skinny Mario, which I fucking almost pissed myself when I saw him. He's a tall, beanpole-looking Skinny Mario. He's very awkward-looking when he jumps. He goes, as he jumps, it's so fucking funny, man.
Mario, this is Mario, guys.
I really had a lot of fun with the game. So far, I've done, what, 3 sections? I did one on launch day.
Didn't you shit on Mario Maker, though, at E3?
I'm actually going to do another session.
Well, he kind of, I don't know, I don't think he completely shit on it.
I'm going to try to make one more really difficult level and put it online for everyone to try. In addition to that, I'm going to be checking out all the levels, again, the top-rated levels that are on the
I can't wait to get the game. I'm going
to
make so many cool levels.
I haven't done that in a week.
But I probably won't for a while. I'll probably make, like...
And I'll be honest.
I'll be honest. Like a chat.
I don't really think that after this session that there's so much else left to do in the game that it would warrant maybe another session. Unless the fans demand it. We want more Mario. Then maybe I'll do another session. But there are new games and stuff coming out this week, and I'd rather focus on that than keep going back to Mario Maker over and over and over. But I had a ton of fun with the game. My only complaint with Super Mario Maker is that, I've said this before and I'll say it again, all the content is not unlocked when you open the game, which is bullshit.
No, that's great.
When you buy...
That's great. I like that.
Adobe Photoshop. Does only half the menu show up when you open it, but then the more that you use Adobe
Photoshop... God, are you kidding me?
Can you think of any other creative application ever in the history of a world that you can buy and...
Super Mario Maker is not an application. That's the difference. You're not making...
No, it makes no
think
sense.
About it. Stupid. If you get Adobe and you and that's your and you, you as a design. Okay. Okay, I'm gonna pause this for this. Great freeze frame. So you let's say you're a graphic designer, you have Photoshop. If they locked, you know, all the tools or half the tools and you have, and more users you have to unlock it and all that shit, you're not gonna get paid because you know it's gonna be harder for you to do all that shit. So yeah, of course they're not going to lock stuff, because it's an application that can be used and applied for a job. Super Mario Maker is a game. It's a video game. If they let everything unlocked from the get-go, that game would lose replayability. You would probably be bored within a week. Nintendo doesn't want you to be bored within a week. The only reason why Phil is bitching about this is because he wanted to play this game. He probably thought he was going to play this game for like 2 weeks and that was it. Then he was like, oh, I have to unlock stuff? Oh, fuck that. This is dumb, and I bet that's why he's shitting on this whole mentality from the 1980s that you have to unlock stuff. It's a game. No games has unlockable stuff anymore. I'm glad Nintendo did that. Nintendo, thank you. I hope more developers follow your idea of having unlockable content. Please, game developers, do what Nintendo's doing and just have unlockable content. Do that, please.
2 hours of content on a cartridge. So timer lock everything so that there's more replayability. It's 2015. It's not 1985.
2015. Make everything easy. Make everything easy. Fuck you. Fuck you, Phil. Fuck you.
And don't time lock your stuff. So what people have been doing
is people like you that ruin gaming to me because like
and they're speeding them forward like 2 weeks. Some people said that if you just sit there in the creator and you go block 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 for 2 hours, you'll unlock all the content. Because that's what I want to do. Sit there and go block, 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 block.
That's
block,
cheating
block.
The game.
I pay my money and I get the product.
That's cheating the game.
I don't like that.
Oh my god. Phil, just stop.
Have to do it different.
So don't say like, well, people are cheating the game, but see, that's how people are doing it. It's like, yeah.
So frustrating that
Nintendo it's frustrating that there's unlockable content. I don't like unlockable content.
Refuses to listen to feedback from the consumer. They refuse to listen to anything the consumer
says. The guy who's refusing to listen to feedback. People want a Project 7, he refuses to listen to that. He took their money and no. People saying that he should do something about that. No, not listening to them. He should continue just recording his gameplay, not streaming. Not gonna listen to that. People liked him recording it, actually. A lot of people liked it. That's why Until Dawn got the best views of him, because people liked that. Not gonna listen to them. He's talking about himself again. I mean, him and Nintendo apparently are the same person.
We may actually see a change because, in fact, I'm going to talk about this as we get to gaming news.
Oh boy. Oh boy.
There's a new change of management within Nintendo, which may be a positive sign, although there's also some pretty negative shit going on with Nintendo on YouTube right now that we're going to talk about in just a few moments.
Oh, what's going on with them on YouTube? I never didn't hear anything about this. Phil is going to educate me, guys, on Nintendo and YouTube. Thank you,
that's
Phil.
It for what I've been doing recently.
Okay.
Now, what am I going to be doing in the next couple of weeks? Let's explain. All right.
This isn't this why you have a week in preview? Why are you doing? Okay.
The name of the game is Soma. You may not have heard of it. I didn't hear about it until about a month ago when I was going through all the new releases. I said, "What the hell is Soma?" And then I looked it up. I was like, "Oh, I'm actually really interested in this." Okay.
What is this? No, no, no.
Survival horror game from the makers of Amnesia: The Dark Descent.
Okay.
Okay, that might have just piqued a lot of people's interest, right? Now, of course, Amnesia
Did he play Amnesia?
Very popular PC-exclusive survival horror game. This one is actually coming both to PC and the PlayStation 4.
Oh, now I'm interested because I heard good things about Amnesia, so there you go.
Because I'll be honest, I don't know if I would have been able to play it if it were a PC-exclusive game because it seems like whenever I try to...
Oh, wait, no, you couldn't play Amnesia because it's a PC game, that's right.
On my PC and then live stream and record it, it doesn't work. My PC can't handle it.
It can't handle it. It's a $3,000 PC, you can't handle it, guys.
Now I'm very interested, and I'm going to be doing it just like I did Until Dawn.
It's $3,000.
Yes, directly to your feedback. Yes, I will be live streaming, but I'll be live streaming with the stream chat right here. The laptop will be closed. I will have face cam. It's going to be just
Dude, that's going to be interesting. I wonder if he's really going to do that.
We can strike gold twice in a month. That'd be pretty awesome. We get two.
Because you could say, I never promised that.
Okay.
You could say, I never promised I wouldn't use stream chat.
Unfortunately.
That's gonna be interesting. That's gonna be interesting. I'll say. I might.
I have to say about Soma on the PlayStation 4, and I want to talk about it now, okay. So everyone's aware.
Okay. Okay.
It's apparently not coming out at midnight, and in fact, you can't pre-order it on PlayStation 4.
Oh no! It's not coming out at midnight. The game listing now, it's now. I don't know if
and
I want this
of
game.
That, what I'm nervous about is that there's not going to be a.
I'm really concerned, guys.
During the day when it will be released. So, perfect example here. Usually, if there's
he has to wait, guys.
Release, you can pre-order the game, comes out at midnight, I can play it ahead of time, right?
Dude.
Great. That's great. This game's not doing that. When games don't have that midnight release, they come out whenever PlayStation Network feels like updating. And I've had this issue
oh my
many
God.
Times this past
he has to wait for the game.
Things came out.
Guys,
like,
you can't just play another game, wait for it to come out, and then do it the next day, or later today, later that day. You can't do it.
And it's very disappointing for everyone.
Dude.
Right? So.
Dude,
I want to play.
I'm feeling for him now.
Soma as soon as possible. If Soma somehow gets a midnight release on PlayStation 4, yes, I'm going to do it. But right now, it's not even listed there. So I can't even get it right now.
You can't even pre-order a digital copy that will never sell out, dude.
We don't know when PlayStation Network will update because Sony still in 2015 didn't make it so that their network updates at the same time every week.
Who cares?
So I wish I could say, yes, we're definitely doing it at this time.
Who cares?
But I can't, and I'm sad to say that. I really
your,
am.
Your schedule can change for that. You can say...
We'll be doing it this week, okay?
Whatever.
Whatever,
Phil.
Looking forward to it because it's good. It's a variety of content. The past few weeks, I've been playing the same games. It'll be great for us to have some variety. And it's going to be the main playthrough that I'm going to focus on for several days this week, which means, yes, that means that if I am playing Soma as my main game, then I'm probably going to have other games take the back burner. So a few days this week, if Soma is the main game that I'll be playing,
see how far I mean.
That games like Mad Max and Fallout
Vegas,
boy. And Fallout 5 will go on the back burner a little bit.
Only...
The good news is, like I said, I'm almost done with Fallout New Vegas.
Shit.
Metal Gear Solid 5,
shit.
I just finished mission 35, and
it's
the game only has, I think, 46 main missions or something
whatever.
Like that. So I'm close to the end of that game.
There's 50, but a lot of them are replays, so...
Metal Gear Solid 5, I may be finishing that game too, which is good. And then it's just Mad Max. Like I said, I'm 70%.
I kind of like the ending of MGS4.
So
I thought I was going to hate it, but...
Like everything...
Not really. I like the ending,
it's
actually.
It's going to be like perfect release time.
It grew on
done.
Me. It grew on
it's
me.
Like,
the ending grew on me.
Playthroughs in time for the new games, and we'll be able to move ahead and not say, oh no, I've got three games lingering, and I'm near the end, and I didn't beat them. I think we're going to be able to push forward through that and not have that happen. I hope. Fingers crossed, okay? So this week, the new release is Soma. The final week of October... There's two new major releases, and I'm going to say this right up front. One of them I'm playing, and one of them I'm not. And
oh, boy.
People are going to be disappointed with this
oh, boy.
But I have made my definitive decision. I think it's the best.
He made his executive decision.
I have decided that I am going to play the new Tony Hawk game because
dude,
I'm not
he's, like, dragging this out. This could have been, like, quick.
I'm
like, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this. But now it's like,
Tony Hawk
okay.
is all about.
I don't know.
I am going to skip NBA 2K16 this year. That is my decision. The only way that
NBA,
I would
dude, he's not doing NBA.
It's a miracle. I finish every game possible before that week, and I really have nothing going on that final week of September. Then maybe I'll get them both. But I really don't want to get into another playthrough that could end up being a lengthy game and not be able to get far into it. Now, I played NBA 2K the past 2 years.
It's like getting really late here, guys. It's like 12... 35.
Because it was the first time I'd ever played
I'm
the game.
Going mad.
Seriously.
Going mad.
And the campaign had a story that year, and it was the first one on PS4. And people really enjoyed it. So then last year I said, oh, I'll do it again. And people really didn't like it that much. They actually did not like the playthrough last
year. Sorry
about
year.
That. They were like, eh, it's more of the same. It's really not that interesting. And without, there were a few funny moments, don't get me wrong. Freaking,
what is
the
this?
NBA players who can barely speak English as it is. That was fucking funny, okay? But.
What? Wait. Did he just say that NBA players can't talk and that's funny? I don't know. I might be. Getting
well,
really
was,
pissed
no,
at. I mean, and
after only, like,
he's
playing,
making
like,
a big deal out
of
nothing, but that's kind of fucked up.
And I stopped playing.
That's really fucked
so,
up. Well, the kids speak English, and they're NBA players, so they're idiots.
I told you there may be an exception. Maybe some crazy shit will happen, and nothing will be coming out, and I'll say, okay, I'll make an executive decision, and I will get the game. But as of right now, I don't have more plans. I don't have plans to play 2K16, but I might. There may still be a last-minute adjustment, but right now, it's kind of out of there, all right? It's kind of out of the contention. In early October, Transformers Devastation, this Gaia 5, the possibility of me playing Rock Band, which I still don't know if I can do. I'm a little worried about
afraid of copyright strikes.
Heroes, we've got Yoshi's Woolly World, Tales of Zestiria, Assassin's Creed Syndicate, Halo 5, WWE 2K16, amongst other things that I probably didn't even mention.
Damn, he's gonna get fucked in October.
We've got the conclusion of Tales from the Borderlands, and we've got the final episode of Life is Strange that at some point...
Yeah, I've fallen behind on Borderlands. Oh, Tales of Borderlands, Jesus. But...
Now I'm exploding here with gas. What's going on? At some point, those releases are coming up, too, and I'm planning those to come out. Probably, I'm expecting them in October. So, October's going to be a pretty insane month, and I didn't even mention Tales of Zestiria because I don't think I'll have time to play it. But I'm hoping for a good October. I think October's going to be pretty good. I do.
I'm sorry if you caught me yawning. I'm sorry about that.
What I'll
it's
be
late.
Up to. Plus, keep in mind, I already mentioned this earlier on the show. At some point, either that last week of September or the first week of October, I'll be doing an Indie Games mini marathon. I will be doing the next
Indie Games. Please do.
We
talked about this
October,
already. Oh my God.
All our goals this month in September for Patreon, I'll be doing the
plug in this Patreon
special. So that's kind of the rough schedule. For the next month to 2 months.
This could have been a very short segment, by the way. He could have...
Oh, big ones. Obviously, Fallout 4 being the biggest, but tons of...
Like, he probably his script is probably just, like, a checklist. Like, talk about this, talk about this, talk about this. And that's fine, but...
DLCs, which we're going to talk about in a moment.
Whoa. Phil, calm down. Jesus. I was listening and he was yelling already. Whoa.
I'm going to give a special thank you shout-out to the following patrons. Who pledged $10 or more?
Dude, why does he sound? Why is he yelling?
Break so that I can come back and be refreshed and do the
like Jesus.
All right. So special thanks to the following patrons who pledged $10 or more for August.
Oh my God.
LC1973, Matt Allen.
Oh, we're not
Brandon
gonna.
Cole, Tom Julie, Connor Gildemeister, Sammy Samosa.
We're not gonna listen to that. I'm sorry. We're not listening. Those people got free plugs, okay? But I'm not gonna give any more. Dude, that was weird. I was, like, looking here, then I was like, Raven! Looks like he's still giving out shout-outs. I don't know why he can't do scroll, but whatever.
Guitar.
Okay, he's still doing it. He's still doing it. How many people donated? I hope Sons of Kojima donated, because, man.
Lucas Team.
Okay, man, come on.
Thank you, okay. Thank you.
You fucking worthless humans
support.
For the views.
Appreciate it. You made this year awesome. And here's hoping that we can continue to have awesome, cool Patreon events in the future, all right? Quick break, everyone. If you're watching this live on stream, just hang out. I'll be back shortly. If you're watching this on...
Mr. Fuck, that's a ripoff of the Young Video Game Nerd. He did the whole thing with Mr. Bucket. I know that's where he got this from, probably. Probably. It's a theory. It's a theory. Don't get... What? What is this? What is going on? Don't tell me. Don't tell me this. Okay, that's very peculiar. Because I know... No. Oh, God. I'm sorry you had to hear that rap. I'm sorry.
Welcome back.
I'm sorry. I know.
Podcast episode 36.
Sorry, my bad.
September 18th, 2015. We're entering the second half of the show.
Okay, good.
It's going to be gaming news.
I don't know why.
Discussion of.
I don't know why
YouTube copyright system.
Oh, probably because
regarding the copyright system, the stuff that I've learned now that I have gotten legal counsel.
That's right, because he probably ended the stream.
Help everyone in the long.
Okay. Okay,
we've got
I know what happened.
Ridiculous
I was doing it when he was doing it live stream, when he was streaming it. Okay.
Meat of the show starting right now. So thanks to those who were watching on stream and didn't quit out during the commercial break because it was a good 70 or 80 people who left the stream. Because
wow, 1,000 and 1,300 viewers.
It wasn't even a commercial, which is hilarious. Whatever. All right. So, ladies and ladies and gentlemen.
So,
let's talk about all the turkey news that has come out of gaming in the past week. There's a ridiculous amount of stories. This is no particular order, all right? First of all,
is there an order for stories? Do people have
A new game was announced by Capcom. And you might be saying, wow, what's the new stuff? Well, Capcom has been announcing all these new characters.
Oh boy, I bet he's going to hop on the bandwagon of people who are hating on Resident Evil Umbrella Corps. I kind of don't like Umbrella Corps, but maybe it's going to surprise me because Operation Raccoon City surprised me, but I'm still kind of, like, I'm used to Capcom not delivering what I want in Resident Evil. I'm kind of, you know, used to it.
For Street Fighter V, recently, including characters like Karen from Street Fighter Alpha.
Karen, I'm interested in, but Rashid is going to be my main. Well, mark my words. If I can't get Cody, Rashid is a good alternate.
Looks pretty interesting, and I have some positive feelings about it. I got a good feeling.
But I want Cody. Give me Cody, Capcom.
Remains to be seen.
Give me Cody. Or give me Hagar.
Capcom says we're going to make a new game, and it's going to be a Resident Evil game.
Oh my god. Great.
Is it going to be Resident Evil, you know, Revelations 3? Is it going
to
be...
I wouldn't expect Revelations 3 after Revelations 3, to be honest.
Coming. We already know that Resident Evil 0 Remake is coming next year. Could it maybe be Resident Evil 3 Remake? That would be interesting.
Oh my god, come on.
No.
I'm tired of them doing remakes. Please, Capcom, after Resident Evil 2 Remake, take a break from remakes do a Resident Evil game.
Or something really just generic and terrible. Umbrella Squadron.
Yep, I knew you were up on the bandwagon.
Because I watched the trailer.
I knew it.
That's what it is, ladies and gentlemen. They show these generic looking guys.
It does look like a free to play game, to be honest. It really does. When I saw it, I was like, oh, this looks like a free to play game. Then it's not.
To attack zombies, but it's also a competitive multiplayer game, and the goal is to survive the zombies while you're also attacking the other players. So it's basically kind of like a third-person Call of Duty.
It's
kind of
like Operation Raccoon City, because that...
And everyone looks
at you're fighting... There's a team deathmatch and zombies in the middle of them, so...
The only thing... I'm watching this trailer. The only thing that's going through my mind is... Does anyone remember a couple years ago...
Oh, Operation Raccoon City.
...when Capcom tried to take the Resident Evil franchise and combine it with another popular franchise called SOCOM? In fact, it was basically an outsourced game that was meant to the SOCOM developers.
Operation Raccoon City got a lot of hate. I kind of like that game. It's not the best game, but I liked it.
It was a terrible, for what it was. Horrible, very
it was fun. That's all it was. It wasn't like, you know, give me more. It was just like, oh, okay, that's something.
Boring and repetitive. There were snippets of greatness within the game, but at no point would I say the game was any kind of legitimate.
It had a lot of bugs, though. I wish it didn't have as much bugs as it was there.
It was a huge critical failure. Critics panned it. Gamers panned it. Didn't sell well. Huge flop for Capcom doing this. So now they're doing it again. Oh, someone finally posted it. Dead Iron 29. I'll give him credit. It's called Umbrella Corps. Umbrella Corps. Third-person, generic, action-based combat with zombies. And everyone who watched this video, just to give you some perspective, when I watched this trailer...
I'm glad we're getting perspective
it
here.
It had 1,000 thumbs up and something like 4,000 thumbs down. I'm not kidding. So four times as many people who said, oh, I might like this game, saw this trailer and said, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you,
fuck you, fuck you, fuck you,
fuck you. Then they
fuck you.
Clone accounts on YouTube and said, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you.
Yeah, they made clone accounts. He's right.
Because I'll be honest, I have no confidence that Capcom can make a tie-in game to the Resident Evil franchise that, number one, is meaningful.
Well, again, Capcom can't make good Resident Evil games anymore. They kind of stopped after 4. 5 was whatever. 6 was kind of like the holding on, like, the edge. Revelations 1 was like, it kind of got up again. Then Revelations 2 just dropped
it.
The fact that they're only doing remakes of major Resident Evil games says something to me.
We had not heard anything of this game until this trailer was released on YouTube, and everyone was like, fuck you! So, that's what's going on in the realm of Capcom right now.
Okay.
A few DLC announcements, ladies and gentlemen, so let's get into them, because one of them I was going to mention earlier, but I didn't mention it because I wanted to mention it in this segment. The Witcher 3 will have its first story-based DLC coming out on October 13th, so it's right smack dab in the middle of October. Which is actually a good time, because if you look at the release window, originally Rainbow Six Siege was supposed to be released that week, but that game has now been delayed till 2016, or at least delayed until late December. I forget, it was some delay. So that's not coming out, which means the only games coming out that week
are
Dragon Quest Heroes and Yoshi's Woolly World, which Yoshi's Woolly World has already been out worldwide for everyone but the United States, so really there's like a big gap that week.
Man, he's really salty about that.
And that's probably the perfect time.
You shouldn't live in Europe. I mean, Europe, they always get games late.
They said it's going to be story-based, it's going to be around 8 to 10 hours long, and you need to be level 30 in-game in order to actually play it. So I'll be honest with everyone, I don't remember what fucking level my character is. I have no clue. I hope I'm level 30.
I hope.
I'm not level 30 and I beat the whole game with all the side content and shit that I did that
before. You could easily check.
I'm pretty sure I'm level 30, but I'm not positive. But I'm looking forward to it. Some people have been saying, Phil, are you going to check out this DLC? And my answer is, yeah, I think that week, it's a new release DLC. I'll play it that week
along Sorry about with that.
Other games and balance out the content I'm doing. And I think that could be really good and a good time for it, okay? And then after I heard about that announcement about the Witcher 3 DLC, I went back and I watched the Umbrella Chronicle or Umbrella Corps trailer, and I said, "Fuck you, thumbs
down." Oh my god, come on, move on from that.
There's another Witcher 3 now. DLC coming out.
Okay.
This one's in November. It's actually November 24th, so it's Thanksgiving week, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, it's the first major DLC for Bloodborne. Yes, Bloodborne, which was critically acclaimed, player acclaimed, sales out the wazoo earlier this year. People have been like, man, we really like Bloodborne, but we beat it, you know, and now we were fiending for another really difficult, ultra-difficult style game from these guys.
When Sorry about that.
From Sorry on. Something, and they announced there will be a DLC. The DLC is going to be a major DLC with bosses and everything. It's not just like a
I think he said Bloodborne is his potential like game of the year as well, so.
And it's going to be released November 24th, as I already said. Now.
Now.
The one thing that's up in the air that everyone is asking, and everyone's like, I wonder how this DLC is going to work, and here's why. In Dark Souls, when you beat the game, okay, you
okay.
could still go back, and you could still wander the game, you could still do the DLCs and stuff afterwards. Not so in Bloodborne. In Bloodborne, once you beat the game, that game officially ends. And you have to start a new game plus, which is actually what I did. If you remember,
I doubt they're gonna be like, "Oh God, play new game plus and do this." I doubt they're gonna do that.
And the boss was a fucking pain in the fucking ass because new game plus just made the game much harder because it did insane amounts of damage with one hit. So, in that regard,
stream chat.
I think that it'll be fun to play Bloodborne again. But the question is, how do you access the DLC? Because if you have to replay the whole fucking game in new game plus to get to a point to play the DLC, I don't think I'm going to get it. And that's a shame because I love Bloodborne. Like, I loved Bloodborne. Right now, it's a leader in my choices for Game of the Year for 2015. And if I have to replay the whole fucking game
Fuck
to play
that.
The DLC, I'm not going to do it.
I'm not going to play my favorite game again.
Back and replay
what do they think I am? To play I like Metal Gear Solid 5. I'm not going to play that game again.
That doesn't make Come sense. On. And
it does make sense. You like the game.
I don't know. I don't know what to do. I really don't know what to do in that okay. regard. And everyone's kind of like, we don't know yet. It's uncertain. There's no answer for that question.
I'm sure we'll when you get the DLC, go to the start screen. There's a start game or start DLC. I have a theory that's how it's going to work.
Dark Souls 3 will be released in April of 2016 in the United States and Europe. Supposedly, the game will be released in Japan a little bit earlier because they said they want to release it as soon as possible in Japan, but they're going to have to take some time to localize it in English for the rest of the world. So I guess we'll see.
Okay, that's okay, but the fact that usually we were went to Europe first, that, no.
I don't know.
I don't know.
We're going to get it in April, but what I'm hoping... Please don't let it fucking come out in, like, January in Japan, and we have to wait 4 months, you know what I mean? Because that's a spoiler, because you know what's going to happen, right?
You know what's going to happen.
January in Japan, everyone will import it, right? Oh, it's imported version, all the crazy-ass fanboys, and the whole fucking game will be on the internet. And that's what's going
to... These crazy-ass fanboys can read Japanese and understand Japanese. So if you play Dark Souls, and it comes out before in the States, you're definitely going to import the Japanese game that has no English in it, because you can read Japanese. Okay, Phil, that's sound logic right there. I mean, the reason why people, like, you know, for Bayonetta, for example, why people, you know, imported that is because the Japanese game has English in it. That's why that was imported, because they were like, oh, why is this still, it was later Call of Duty. Dark Souls 3, I doubt has an English, the fact that, localize and do all the English stuff, why would it be English in the Japanese game? So if they import it, they're gonna just have to guess in the menus because it's all in Japanese, and guess everything because it's all in Japanese. Why would Dark Souls fans do that? And it, I don't know. That to me is weird. You know, if you're a Dark Souls fan and you're gonna import the game, please let me know. You know, and see why. Is it because you're gonna understand Japanese, or is it because you like the? I don't know.
Is the whole game will be out months ahead of time, and then finally we get to play it. It's like, well, you know, it'll still be fun, but it's not as fun as when you're playing the game brand new and everyone.
Oh, I have an hour left. Oh man.
So please let it be like a short delay.
Oh man.
6 months delay.
I'm sorry, this is gonna be a long video. I'm sorry. This is
okay.
No, I intended this video at all, but.
Oh, okay. Let's.
If you watch this, thank you. Thank you for watching.
No, I'm sorry. I already misspoke.
And thank you for sticking around.
Fucking confusing. Kingdom Hearts 2.8 HD Remix. What?
Huh?
2.8. We already had 2.5. Yeah. We had Kingdom Hearts 1.5.
Not surprised Kingdom Hearts did that. I'm not surprised.
Cutscenes from one game and an expansion game or something.
Why not do Kingdom Hearts 3? I don't know why they're wasting your time with 2.0 whatever.
Kind of expansion side games and then more cutscenes. Kingdom Hearts 2.8, which is supposed to be like Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep, which I guess was the 3DS version of the game that most people didn't play because they don't have it on 3DS.
And I thought they put that on the PSD already.
Cutscenes from another game, a mobile game of Kingdom Hearts that no one fucking played because, let's face it, everyone who played Kingdom Hearts played it on PlayStation, or
how many
if they went and got a 3DS
places did they release Kingdom Hearts, man? I mean, that series was more like hoarded out way more than Resident Evil 4. And Resident Evil 4 was hoarded out a lot.
We have a fan base that's primarily on Sony consoles and some that are on the 3DS. Let's create a mainstream game in the line of Kingdom Hearts story with a story that's like necessary and canon, and let's do it only on mobile devices. That's gonna sell. Stupid. And of course, that game failed. I forget what it was called, but it failed.
So
now they're basically taking the cutscenes out of that game and putting it into this collection.
Yeah, you know, at this point, like, why bother with the handheld games? And if you're just going to release it on consoles, just release it on consoles then. I don't know what Square is doing with Kingdom Hearts. I thought they knew what to do with them. So, Kingdom Hearts 1, Kingdom Hearts 2, great. Alright, what about Kingdom Hearts 3? Well, we're just going to do a handheld games now. Okay. And make HD collections. Okay, Square. That's what Kingdom Hearts fans want. They don't want 3. They don't want Kingdom Hearts 3.
I could play more than one Kingdom Hearts game in a year. So there's a possibility that maybe come 2016, I'll play that other game that was in the 2.5 collection, alright? But then when 2.8 HD Remix comes out, I'm not doing that, so then maybe I'll do that. And who knows, the thing that a lot of people are saying is this disappoints them, because this kind of makes you believe that Kingdom Hearts 3 is further out than we hoped. We were all thinking maybe it'll be out late 2016, maybe late 2017. Now that people heard about this collection, they're like, oh, shit. Maybe now it's not going to come out until like 2018.
But it's like an HD port, so I can't imagine that taking that long to kind of work on. I don't know.
This is just milking the franchise at this point. Like, milking the shit. Taking the cow's udder.
On my computer?
Squeezing every fucking little drop of Kingdom Hearts milk out of it that you can get to make extra money.
Wow, what a...
they haven't really been releasing new games recently. And that's kind of disappointing. So we'll see what happens, but that was a weird announcement for me, and honestly, am I that interested? Not really. I'm not. I mean, like I said, maybe next year I'll play one Kingdom Hearts game, maybe the year after, but there's no
so
way
I want to make sure that
play
is...
every one of these collections. No, it's ridiculous. It's milk, 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 milk.
Milk, milk, milk. Sorry, I just want to make sure that the space
that
bar
like
is the pause. Sorry about that.
All right, let's talk a little bit about Nintendo.
Great,
we've
yes.
Got some good news, some bad news, some
tell me.
News.
Right. Educate me about Nintendo.
First of all, the good news. Nintendo finally has a new CEO.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. A couple months back, it's actually been a couple months now, we lost Mr. Iwata, Satoru Iwata.
Probably monetize this video, but whatever.
And since then, there's been this big kind of gap, a big hole in Nintendo. Like, who's going to take this leadership position? Who's going to lead the company into the next generation? Will the person who leads Nintendo next have a different vision than Iwata did? And the person to take the reins, his name is Tatsumi Kimishima. He's actually the previous head of the Pokemon Company, which is actually a corporation that is exclusive.
I heard good things from this guy. I mean, like, you know, a lot of the Pokemon games that he worked on were really good, I heard. So that's promising to me.
manager for Nintendo, okay?
I think he was with Nintendo for like 10 years. So I mean, and he got King promotion, so he's doing something right.
He is a balding elderly man who looks like a typical, like you would
Are
think,
you kidding me?
When you think stodgy, upper class,
he's old guys. Japanese like, who cares man, if he's old or not?
Look at a picture of Mr. Kimishima, like, dead on. Like that, ding, 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 like right on the button. And I think a lot of people, actually, when they first saw a picture of Mr. Kimishima, said, oh, shit. Like, this is bad because Nintendo is out of touch with its audience for the past several years. Ever since the launch of the Wii U, they don't listen. They think they know better than everyone.
Talking about himself again. But when I saw him, when I saw the guy taking him out of his position, all I was thinking was, like, you know, he got some shoes to fill, but, you know, it's not like, you know, some guy who didn't work at Nintendo is taking that job. And I'm like, oh, well, we got someone from Activision to work for Nintendo. No. I'm glad that they have this guy. Actually, I think it's a good pick.
Our mobile gaming device from Nintendo, and plus Nintendo's about to launch a bunch of mobile games on mobile IPs, like the iPhone, right?
Like Pokemon Go, and I don't really care about Pokemon Go.
You know, it's an uncertain time for Nintendo. Right now, Nintendo sales of the Wii U are and it could end up being the worst-selling console in their history. The games that are coming out for this console are not selling.
Not selling,
they're in a
okay.
lot of trouble. The only thing that's selling is fucking Amiibos, which is not their business, so they're really lucky that Amiibos have...
Wait, so if Amiibos can be used in games, so if the games aren't selling, how come the Amiibos are outselling the games? I mean, I gotta honestly kind of... Super Smash? I don't know. Super Smash Bros. Kind of makes sense because you want to get all, you know, all the characters, I don't know. It's. I feel like that there should be a good ratio with Amiibos and
he said, I do not
games.
Have any plans to change... the creative direction, or the actual ideal vision...
That's good.
Of what Mr.
That's
Iwata
really good.
So
I'm glad he said that.
Iwata. And when he said that, we all basically collectively put our hands in our heads like this and said, oh!
No, I'm actually happy. Because I'm glad he's understanding the legacy Nintendo has, and he's like, oh, I'm just going to continue it, because it would be more troublesome if he says... Yeah, you know what, Iwata was great, but I'm not going to do what Iwata did. I'm just going to do something else, and it might, you know, sink the company even worse. I don't know. I feel that he said, you know, the right thing. I don't know what Phil's talking about. I don't know. I haven't heard anyone do this at all. This is he's the only person who I've heard him kind of be worried
why?
About this guy.
Why?
No one said why.
Has Nintendo done right in the past 5 years? Name one fucking thing that as a gaming company, not an action figure or collectibles manufacturer.
Maybe Super Mario Maker.
As a gaming company,
that looked like a really fun game. I'm gonna get that. Super Smash Brothers. That was a great game. They're online and
well, besides crickets.
Then the online. The online is way better than the Wii. It's actually more usable.
So. I'm going to follow along with that. That sounds like a good idea. No, it doesn't.
What else?
That's a dunderheaded statement that he said, okay?
He made Amiibos.
There is
made Amiibos and
lining to this dark cloud. Mr. Kimishima
is a businessman like me.
Nintendo management. When Nintendo was actually developing the Wii U, he actually stood up and told the upper management of Nintendo, I don't think that this is going to be a good idea.
When did he say this? I never heard this.
Too similar to the Wii. I don't think there's a competitive advantage to the Wii U, and I don't think that there's a reason for gamers to buy the Wii U. And of course, the upper, you know,
when did he say that?
Well, we're going ahead anyway, and look what happened. So
when did he say this?
Dissenting voice in the group.
I never heard this before. I don't know. Maybe I wasn't, you know, looking hard enough.
When these big critical decisions are coming up regarding Nintendo NX.
A lot of haters say that he's pulling this stuff out of his ass. He is, because I never heard this.
Because we feel that we're not in competition with others. Mr. Kimishima will say, are you a fucking retard? No. It has to be at least as good as the other console.
He tells. Oh, man. Okay. You know what? I'm going to say this before I make this joke. I have no ill will towards Iwata. He made great games. You know, he helped Nintendo, you know, a lot where he was. He's a great man, okay? He's a great man. I was really deeply sorry that he passed away and all this stuff, you know. But, man, just imagine the guy in the room saying, oh, yeah, we're going to do the Wii U. You're a fucking retard. No, that's not how people talk. I know he's joking, but that's a dumb joke to make.
Or else why would someone buy it, dingus?
Dingus?
But we don't know.
We don't know anything.
And,
like, his sources. He doesn't know where his sources came from.
Now, the bad news.
Bad news time.
The bad news for you here, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, Star Fox. The new Star Fox, I think it's called Star Fox Zero, the one for Wii U.
Yeah.
That just got a release date. Like, no lie, it just got a release date for sometime in, was it November, I think? Or it might have been October. It just got a release date.
Okay, what's the bad news? This sounds good.
Nintendo says, well, scrap that. Sorry. All right, what? You just gave the game a release date. Nope, scrap that. Star Fox is now delayed until 2016.
Oh, okay.
Like, oh, no. Because that was really the only thing that Nintendo had
for the
holiday season.
Oh, no. Nintendo's delaying a game to make it better for some reason? I mean, didn't Miyamoto say a delayed game will eventually be a good game than releasing a game that's not whatever? I know Miyamoto said something about delayed games and how you know, it was better to delay a game than release it when it should have been delayed or whatever. So
There's nothing else.
What's Nintendo supposed to do? Well, we have to release it in November, guys. We have to, or October. We have to release it. But, sir, the game isn't finished. There's a bug here that's going to cause us... No, we're still... No, we have to sell. We have to compete with other consoles. Good job, Phil. He's a businessman. He knows business.
Oh, shit. Well, Super Mario Maker, you know? It's like, yeah, Wii U...
And Yoshi Woolly World.
...release years ever, and there's nothing coming out for
this isn't the worst... No, the worst one was when the Wii U came out. Sorry, that's the worst one.
What the fuck? So the one big one is gone. So now, like, that's it. After I'm done with Super Mario Maker, my Wii U will now collect dust for another 6 months. It's a shame.
They should have released the game when it wasn't finished, dude.
This one is just fucking stupid. Stupid. Mean, this is just beyond fucking stupid.
Nintendo fan over here, by the way.
But Nintendo is Nintendo, right? And it doesn't surprise me.
Take a sit. Check out Tevin's content, please.
Well-known speedrunners on YouTube.
People speedrunners.
Or at least have renown for being speedrunners of games. Have had all of their videos of Nintendo games flagged and content ID claimed by Nintendo. So we're talking people who, you know, I played Super Mario, and of course, let's face it, anyone who probably is a speedrunner of Super Mario probably fucking owns Super Mario, you know. If I'm going to speedrun the game...
No, I know there's speedrunners that emulate the game. Just saying. I don't think they... I don't think a lot of them own them.
To do things like save states and things like that to try to get the best absolute time. Apparently, speedrunners are having their videos content ID claimed and in some cases, even copyright stricken and taken down by Nintendo on YouTube. So, these are videos that have been out there for years. Like, we're talking to people who started doing speedruns 5 years ago, are getting their videos stricken down, claimed, and taken off of YouTube by Nintendo, and it's like an epidemic. Everyone in the speedrunners...
It's an epidemic. I don't think the speedrunners are, like, that devastated. They're probably like, this sucks, but they're not like, guys, they flagged our content. My life is ruined.
Level, how quickly you could beat them. This is free promotion. You've never had an issue with it. Now, all of a sudden, we're going to do this.
But weren't they
good? It's just absolutely ridiculous. And there's no reason.
I would have figured this would have happened because they did this.
Content ID claiming everyone's videos, you know, claiming that it's their legal property when fucking it's not.
They might have made the game, but it's not theirs.
And Nintendo, really, what has to happen, and this is won't ever happen, what needs to happen is fairly simple.
They need to get sued.
A YouTuber who's a millionaire has their videos taken down by Nintendo or content ID claimed by Nintendo. That millionaire then goes and hires a real copyright lawyer.
Real one, not a fake one.
Whatever kind of lawyer, right? And sues the living fuck out of Nintendo. And then it would be fixed. But
yeah, it would be fixed.
The problem is the people who do this, right? They're gamers, they're fans, they're kids. They're not people like me and you. We don't have money to go to court to defend our videos.
Okay, let's say I upload a speedrun of a Nintendo game or a Nintendo game playthrough, whatever, and that gets stricken down from Nintendo. They removed that and all that shit. I probably wouldn't care. I probably would be like, oh, that sucks. I mean, but I would have understood why it was taken down. I would have understood that because it's they don't feel it's fair. I mean, I think it's a two-way street. I can understand both why the less player would be might be upset. I can understand why Nintendo's upset about it. But, you know, this doesn't affect the common gamer because the common gamer doesn't do YouTube as a living. They just play games, dude. I'm a common gamer because I don't stream my shit. I don't, you know, don't have these copyright issues with my video games because I don't stream my video game stuff here. I just play games. I don't really like make a living off my Let's Plays. I don't have any Let's Plays. I might have Skullgirls stuff up, but you know, that's being uploaded through Sony's official system, and that's not monetized, which is different. I don't know. I just feel that he
videos, so we can't sue Nintendo, and YouTube will not do anything about it because they're a bunch of pussies.
Oh, YouTube's pussies. They work. He's working on YouTube, but they're pussies.
A bunch of kick over little take it up the butt fucking. I don't want any litigation. Oh my God. Even when I have legal.
Dude. Okay, you know what? This is something I said. I commented on a video. This guy, okay, he got his streaming taken away within a week or so. He got his streaming privileges back. Most YouTubers that have that problem, who get stricken down and all that stuff and can't stream, they have to wait 10 days. They have to wait for 10 days. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. YouTube's not going to give a shit about them. He didn't have to sit through 10 days to get his streaming capabilities back. He asked Machinima about it. Machinima bothered YouTube, and then YouTube, reduced his punishment. Oh, this punishment because it's false. It's ridiculous. And now he's shit-talking YouTube after getting special treatment. That's like, going to, being thrown in jail. And then, you spend like a week in jail and you have a life sentence, you have a sentence of like, 5 years. And then he's like, oh, well, you'll spend 2 years and you can go back to life, you can go back in the real world and all that. And they're like, okay, great, thanks. Then that happens and later on, the fucking jail is a piece of shit. They're all fucking assholes, and they're assholes. They're idiots. Fuck them. It's like, dude, you got out of a 5-year sentence. So yeah, fuck you, Phil. I mean, most people who had this problem don't get these weakened fucking sentences, and he...
I won't fucking mess with it. Bullshit pussies.
Because calling YouTube pussies after they gave him like a 5-day, like, slap on the wrist.
Wow.
And they removed his strikes, too.
But the bottom line is, Nintendo is bullying gamers.
Nintendo is bullying gamers. Wow. 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 Wow.
Joke. It's a joke.
Wow. Dude. Bullying gamers. Okay.
There is a YouTuber, I forget her name, and I apologize. I was going to give her a plug, and I fucking forgot her name.
Yeah, sure, you forgot.
She's a YouTuber who's known for doing more like cutesy playthroughs, okay? She's got about 70,000 subscribers on YouTube. She's got about 11 million views, so is she anywhere near like a big YouTuber caliber? Of course not. But she's got a decent following, and when she puts out videos, she gets a decent amount of
more decent than his following.
She joined Nintendo's content program. Remember there's that Nintendo Partner Program? She joined it because she could not upload Nintendo content. Her content was all getting content ID claimed. And because of that, all right, there was no way she could upload Nintendo content on it. So she joined their partner program, all right?
You don't make sure the pause button is the space bar.
And all this happened. Boom, 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 boom.
She joins
the program. All right.
Okay.
She finally uploads some videos.
Oh my God.
They're all under Nintendo's program.
Oh my God. Let's get to the point.
Supposedly Nintendo's taking its cut. She's taking her cut. Yada yada yada. Ah yes. Is it her? No, it's not her.
Oh my God, Phil.
I just said a name in the stream chat. That's not her. But anyway, this YouTuber finally got her first paycheck.
This is driving me insane.
After all this months of processing and finally joining the Nintendo partnership program and revenue share and all that, because she really likes Nintendo content, she finally got her first monthly paycheck from Nintendo. Guess how much money she made on all the thousands of views she brought in on her
$1?
$0.01.
Oh, $0.01.
One.
On my channel, on my other channel, I made 15 cents. Man, I'm really, I guess I got bullied by YouTube. So I should really be pissed off by that. I guess I should stop making videos and say, wow, I got paid 15 cents that I haven't even gotten yet because I said, fuck, I'm not going to cash that in. And I have all these videos. I have, I got, 50 views on, like, a video, got, like, whatever views, and I got 15 cents, man. Maybe less than 15 cents, actually. I mean, I haven't made a dollar on my channel, and I've been on that channel for for years now. So, yeah. Okay. Okay, Phil. Clearly, she should definitely change her lifestyle.
Penny! I'm not joking.
YouTube isn't a career. That's the thing people need to understand. YouTube isn't a steady career that you can thrive off of.
No, she gets decent views on her videos. She made a penny of profit.
It's harder work to make a living on YouTube. It's really hard.
Does that give you any confidence that Nintendo is legit in wanting to share the revenues of their any videos of their games? Does it really? No.
Same with YouTube, I guess. I mean, YouTube doesn't want to share their revenues with me. You don't, dude. I got, like, 15 cents, dude. That they're not sharing any of their billions of dollars.
At the core is run by a certain family of people who are very Japanese culture centric.
Oh, god damn it, Phil. Don't. This is Japanese culture, guys. I know, because I'm a gamer, and I know Japanese culture. Wow, dude. This isn't Japanese culture. This isn't Japanese culture. This is kind of ridiculous. I don't want to say this is racism, but it's like on the edge of racism. Like anyone can, if you watch this video, just let me know. Is what he said that this is Japanese culture racist? That he's saying no, it's you know whatever, because it feels that way, dude. It feels like it. I just don't want to say that it is yet.
I'm kidding you. This is true. Is superior to everyone else. They know better than everyone, they're smarter than everyone, and therefore, they don't listen. They're very xenophobic.
I guess Apple is Japanese. I guess Apple is a Japanese company then. And they're xenophobic, apparently. They're very xenophobic. No, like, that's like saying a Greek who makes Greek food and, you know, and loves Greek food. Like, I mean, I prefer Greek food over America. I guess I'm xenophobic. Because I like Greek food more than American food. I guess that makes me xenophobic. And I think, you know, no, Phil, that's wrong. You're wrong. No.
I don't believe that anyone else outside of the Japanese should have any kind of ownership or fair use or anything of anything that...
That's why they have Nintendo of America, because they don't trust them.
Why do you think that Nintendo keeps making bonehead decisions and won't listen to feedback from gamers? Because they think they know better than everyone.
Talking about himself. I guess he's Japanese, dude. Maybe that... No, it's not racist. He's a Japanese man talking about other Japanese people.
It's right for them to claim their content. It's right to say we're making a partnership program and we'll revenue share with you and you join their program and they pay you a penny. They think that's good. We did good. Because we're Nintendo. That's how dumb they are. They're like fucking brainwashed idiots are at the head of Nintendo.
This is
that's
torture. Like, if you want me... Brainwashed idiots. Here's the thing. If you want to, like, get information out of me, just play this... Play DSP videos like this. HateLive videos, I would probably, like, crack. Dude, this is awful. This is the worst thing I've seen. Like, I have nothing to say. Like, that kind of says it for itself. Like, you should know what I'm thinking just by looking at me at this point. Like, a facepalm doesn't, like, accurately describe this shit. Seriously, okay? Like,
Konami! Oh, more good news!
Oh, more Shion Konami 2-2. Dude, like, you guys see where my attitude kind of went from the start to now? It's like,
all this talk about Konami, all rumors behind the scenes about how a Metal Gear Solid 5 was being developed, that there was a falling out between Kojima and Konami.
Okay.
And that, you know, Kojima got the boot, the whole team Kojima, Kojima Productions all got laid off after Metal Gear Solid 5 was released. And then, you know, Silent Hills was canceled, the new game. And basically everything that we've heard from Konami is that they're not going to be really caring about video games anymore. Only they're going to care about is mobile games, mobile video games, and pachinko. And in fact, since all...
Who cares at this point? Swirling, like, everyone was already out the door with Konami after MGS5. No one gives a shit about them.
Castlevania, the sexy adventure violent game, pachinko game, and a new Silent Hill pachinko game, but no word of new video games of these franchises.
Well, yeah, because they're focused on their successful business, not the one that they've been feeling yet.
Konami has announced that they have halted all production on AAA game development.
Okay.
And the only games that they will be developing in the future are mobile video games and PES, which I believe is like something...
PES.
It's a soccer game. It's a football football/soccer game. It's a franchise that I guess is a successful
football
franchise.
Slash soccer. I think this is a soccer game.
Too much money invested in it, or for some reason they're continuing on with that. They're canceling everything else. There will be no more Castlevania games. There will be no more Silent Hill games. They have canceled everything.
Yeah, because like those games have not been doing, you know, good.
Their wings that aren't making mobile games.
So there you go.
Official as of today.
I don't care. I was buying Konami games after this, and MGS5 was a good buy for me.
Wow. We're talking about a game company, and I've said this before, that was synonymous with greatness in the 1980s and 90s.
I don't think it was synonymous with greatness. I didn't hear that much from Konami to begin with. All I heard was about Castlevania and Silent Hill. But I didn't hear them like, oh man, Konami. Like, it's on the same level as Nintendo, Sega, and maybe Capcom. No, Capcom, yeah, because fighting games. So Sega, Capcom, and Nintendo were like the top three. Konami was there. It's like the Japanese EA to me, but...
I can't believe Silent Hill, one of, if not arguably, the best survival horror game of the modern gaming era, is now dead.
Did he play Silent Hill?
What's fucked up about all of this is that we actually heard from Konami when they said that Silent Hills was canceled. They said, oh no, we might still work on it, it just won't have Kojima in it. And now they're literally admitting today, well,
they didn't say they can still work on Silent Hill, they were saying that they're into making more Silent Hill.
Now the thing that really...
But that could change as well, they could change that decision of no AAA games, or whatever. Oh boy, MGS5 again.
And I said, the one thing that I don't understand, and if people could please explain this to me,
Fuck.
Because we know there was a falling out between Kojima and Konami.
Oh my god. The game came out and he still doesn't know why people bought it. I talked about this.
Fuck you. And they're giving him the boot. And they're treating him like shit. Him and all his people are being treated like shit. We know this. Like, we know this from behind the scenes. Kojima's admitted it and everything. So why
I'm like
are people so gung-ho to go buy Metal Gear Solid
5?
Why are people
this.
Like, want to buy it and support this company that's...
I've never, like, wanted to rage quit a DSP video in a long time.
All the responses that I got.
This might be
all
the first time, but I don't know. I'm gonna try to stick through it, guys.
Metal Gear Solid 5 is Hideo Kojima's magnum opus.
Yeah.
It's the best game he'll ever make. And therefore,
that's why I bought
it. It's not only a disservice to the gamers, it's a disservice to Mr. Kojima. Because obviously he's put so much time and effort into the game that we want to experience his final game. And therefore, regardless of if the company is mistreating him, we feel that Kojima as an artist would want us to experience his final magnum opus. Okay.
Okay.
Fair enough. But how do you feel now that Metal Gear Solid 5 is a bestseller? And you now know, definitively, as
wait,
of today, this announcement,
all of your money
is going towards pachinko games and mobile games and to line the fucking pockets.
Okay, I'll stop him here for a second. I know where this is going. How I feel about my money going towards that is this. Yeah, they're going to survive. They're going to, like, thrive off of that, of my money for, like, you know, a day or a while or whatever. But once that money runs out, guess what Konami's gonna be? Is gonna wish happened. See, Phil isn't thinking long term. See, I bought the game. I bought MGS5. I bought it, and I just said to myself, "Well, they could have my money for this game. After this, they better get. You know, they better like my money for now because they're not getting my money again. You know that's what happened." I bought the game because I wanted to see Kojima's last game because he worked really hard on it and he probably wanted his fans to play the game. I'm a fan of Metal Gear, so I played the game and that's my thoughts on the game. And that's why I gave Konami my money.
Of Konami management, and they are laughing at you.
They're not
laughing at you, the Metal Gear Solid 5 hardcore fan, and people who are big fans of Hideo Kojima.
I'm laughing at them because they got rid of Kojima. They got rid of their moneymaker. So they made this money because of Kojima. This money that they're getting is because of Kojima. Now that he's gone, what is Konami going to do now? How are they going to get my money again? They're not going to get it again. So I get the last laugh. They're going to be, you know, struggling after this.
Kojima and everything.
That's how I think about it.
They said,
so I'm laughing at them.
You fucking fell for it. You ran out and you gave all the media outlets 10 out of 10, best game ever. You
know, he makes it sound like Kanai is like Dr. Evil or something. Like, oh, we got him, we got him.
And all the money goes to people who don't care, who aren't going to make a better game, who aren't going to help Kojima, who aren't going to do jack diddly shit, but make garbage out of their company.
Can I comment on this?
Because you fell for it. And that's all I have to say.
Nothing beats the King. Okay, that's the first comment.
That maybe you want to play the
I'm definitely going to comment something on your show. Stay tuned for that later. It's not going to be in this video because you don't want to see that.
You know? For me, I'm not a huge Kojima fanboy. I'm not, and I never have been. I respect the Metal Gear Solid
series. Fuck it.
I like it as a game series. I do. I like it. And I think that it's a good series. I really think Kojima could be really well done as like a director, as a movie producer or something, or director. I think he could do a really good job as that. But I really staunchly am like disgusted by this news that these fuckers took our money and now they're running with it. That's it. They literally said, well, let's wait a few weeks till after Metal Gear Solid 5 is a hit and then we'll say fuck you to everyone. That's what they said, fuck you. They could have literally, they didn't even need to announce this. They could have just said, fuck you. Kojima, this is a pussy. Fuck you. Thanks for, they have your money right in their hand. Here's your money. Yes, I'm on my yacht. Yes, come blow me. Get them some coke off your thighs. I love it. That's basically what happened. Really what happened today.
They lost their money maker. And now they won't receive any more money.
Because Silent Hill is a great franchise. I love Silent Hill. I want to see new Silent Hill, modern Silent Hill.
Or any other
someone get it,
old school
I don't want to see it die Konami because of these games. Fuckers. I can't stand it. And I want to fucking choke the motherfuckers like this. I'll take their faces and fucking smash them. Because I'm bullshit. Okay. So anyway, everyone, that's it for gaming news. I know that was a lot of news to cover. All right. Now, the final segment of my podcast for tonight. Let's talk about YouTube. Let's talk about copyright law. All right. And let's talk about what happened to me over the years. As you know, I've been uploading videos to YouTube since 2008.
Konami
back before I was ever part of Machinima, and I just had my own private channel.
Is pretty fucking stupid.
I have copyright issues.
I never
that I had copyright strikes issued against my of yours YouTube account, my old YouTube
that
account,
made me
and I could have two specific instances where this happened. One
like
of them happened
I was
when WWE
tortured.
Apparently filed a copyright strike against
this
me
is
one of the games
awful.
Of theirs I was playing actually had footage of like
how
pay-per-views.
You.
And I argue that's bullshit. It's in your game. I'm doing a let's play of your game.
So
it should be protected
under
fair use. WWE
bullshit.
Sold differently,
and
therefore
not
that copyright strike was applied to my account. Then months
bullshit.
Later, I was doing a playthrough of Grand Theft Auto 4's The
you
Lost Damn DLC when it was released.
Me.
Brand new.
I can't
and I got a copyright strike from Rockstar Games telling me to take
I
down
hear.
The videos. And I said, I completely disagree. I think that this is fair use. A let's
wow.
play is fair use. Not only does it include my gameplay, my commentary, this Let's Play is a creative work that is considered a derivative or transformative work. It's not just the raw game. It's me adding my own flair to it, and it wouldn't exist if it weren't.
Okay, I don't know what he's talking about now, but who cares? I'm glad I made that comment, to be honest. Jesus.
And I disagree. I actually disputed the claims.
Oh, he's talking about claims.
Copyright strikes that I received, and those were rescinded.
But YouTube is a bunch of pussies, though, Phil.
So
I mean,
I don't know if they weren't legit or what. I never got
they're pussies. They didn't give you the full 2 weeks. They're fucking pussies.
Now we're going to talk about
okay,
April
Phil.
Of 2010. This, I guess you could call this kind of D-Day
D-Day.
My YouTube career.
Wow.
Because this was really the definitive day when I was attacked by a blatant troll.
He was attacked, dude. He was attacked.
This troll fooled YouTube's copyright strike system. And I finally got my first understanding of how the system worked. But quite honestly, I think that because this happened, it kind of made me like the underdog of YouTube. Like, who is this guy who's making fun gameplay videos? He's doing nothing wrong, and people are abusing YouTube and fucking with him. We want to see him succeed. And it's actually, I think, where I got some of my viral popularity was because of these copyright strikes that actually shut down my Dark Side Phil channel on YouTube. And this copyright strike actually happened when I was playing Splinter Cell. There was a Splinter Cell game. I forget which. I think it was Splinter Cell Blacklist or something like that. I don't remember. Or it might have been Splinter Cell Conviction. I don't remember what the game was. It was a Splinter Cell game. And I was like 2 days into the playthrough of Splinter Cell. And I received a copyright strike that said it was from Ubisoft, the game developer of Splinter Cell, saying, you know, copyright strike, legit against your account, copyright violation, and it shut down my Darkseidphil account because I already had those WWE claims against the account. So it counted as like three strikes, and it shut down my Darkseidphil channel.
Uh-oh.
I disputed this claim. At the same time, people, viewers of mine, fans, started tweeting the Ubisoft Twitter and started going to the Ubisoft forums and spamming the shit out of the moderators there saying, why would you take down Darkseidphil's channel? What the fuck is your problem?
Those poor moderators.
He's advertising your game for free. Why would you take down your channel, you fucking shitheads?
And wow, those poor moderators.
Went through all these different channels, Twitter, and also these forums.
I feel sorry for Ubisoft at that point.
Come to find out, Ubisoft spoke up and said, we didn't do this. We never submitted a copyright strike against Phil. This is nonsense. Someone must be impersonating us, or YouTube has wrong information. As soon as Ubisoft said that, later that day, the copyright strike changed and said no longer Ubisoft. It said this was filed by a guy named Steve Jones.
Steve Jones.
Who the fuck is Steve Jones? And why is YouTube so fucking stupid that they would shut down someone's YouTube channel for false information? It's actually illegal.
Guys, I'm sick again, guys. I gotta stop. I gotta stop recording.
That actually could be documented. You could go to jail for it. You could be sued for it. It's against the law to file false copyright claims. Okay? So, the good news is, in 2010, I got this reversed, and of course, no one ever explained how this could have happened.
There's a bug here. Right? Sound like
I got
a
shut down by a false copyright claim. It was an impersonator. It wasn't
dude, you could definitely.
This is ridiculous. Really,
this is the most ridiculous video. I really don't know what to say.
And stuff like that.
I came. I am back doing a video on DSP. My friend here, and I feel like I'm being tortured.
So, that's the good news, is that really I didn't have any more issues that for a long, long time. Then, I'll be honest
it's
with you.
It's 1:30, guys. Please tell me I'm getting close to 2 hours.
I'm not, because I don't want to get too far into legal matters.
Okay, 35 minutes. I'm 35, an hour 35 minutes in. Great.
About the situation. However, great. I will tell you this. Over the years, there have been tons of people on YouTube who have illegally downloaded my video. And use them in.
I'm not downloading this video, by the way. You can see I'm on his channel, so.
Defamatory.
There you go.
You know, conciliatory.
I'm part of the 1,300, Phil. All right. Part of the 1,300 views.
And I legally looked into it, and I can
part of it.
Right now, because I looked into it with an
attorney. I might regret.
And the attorney told me that Phil.
Here I am.
There's very few cases where you could justify that someone took your gameplay videos, your Let's Plays, and used it for anything, and could consider it. Fair use. Like, there are very, very few and far between cases where it would be considered fair use. And I'll be honest with everyone. There's particular videos out there, you know what they are, negative videos about me that use my content. And I talked to YouTube, or not YouTube, excuse me, I talked to an attorney about it, a copyright attorney. And this attorney told me directly to my face, that is illegal, what people are doing with your videos, and you have the legal right to tell YouTube to take those videos down because they are illegal. In the eyes of the United States copyright law, they are illegal, okay? They're not fair use. And what I then found out, unfortunately, was that, unfortunately, it didn't matter if it was illegal or not. And here's why. Here's what I learned about YouTube's copyright.
Shocking truth. Gentlemen.
The only way that you can actually get a video taken off of YouTube, and I'm not kidding you, this is 100% confirmed both by attorneys and Machinima and YouTube. I've talked to all these parties. I've confirmed it with the higher-ups. The only way that you can actually have a video taken off of YouTube permanently is to sue the person. So, for example, let's say that...
What?
How can I... I'm trying to give
a wait, example here. Wait. So, back in this video, he talked about... Nintendo taking down that person's video on her speedrun, whatever. So you're telling me, Phil, Nintendo sued her. They sued her, and then they got the video taken down. Or, you know, I've followed other channels, like, I'll drop a name right now. Digibro. I followed him. I'm subscribed to him. He had his videos taken down. he wasn't sued. So you're telling me that he does anime reviews and all that. So the anime company went to Digibro, sued him. See, this is why I kind of don't buy what he says, because I've never heard people getting sued and their videos taken down. Like, this other YouTuber who's a hater, Loophole, he did a This Is How You Don't Play Minecraft of his. That video got taken down. From Phil, DSP flagged that video and got taken down. Did DSP sue him? No. So why was the video taken down? And, yeah, I guess you could say this is a negative video, but this is just a conversation piece. Because he's talking, I'm reacting to it. This is a reaction video, basically. This is me reacting to what he's saying. I don't hate the guy, obviously. I've said that so many times. But he says some dumb stuff. I wish no harm to him. I think, you know, he should keep doing what he wants to do, but he should at least realize some of the stuff he says is ridiculous. And I know if you're watching this video, you understand that's the point of these videos. So I'm just saying this as a disclaimer. But if you're watching this video, I hope you understand what the point of this video is.
Someone felt that someone had stolen a video of theirs and put it on their channel illegally.
Oh wait, no, yeah, that's right. That's different. It's different,
much
I guess.
How evidence you have? Okay, it doesn't matter how much legal counsel
I guess.
You have.
I guess that's different.
It doesn't matter if you're 100% legally in the right. Like, let's say today, this video, this podcast, if someone downloaded it off of the King of Hate blogs and uploaded it, literally, no commentary, no editing, just purely on their channel on YouTube. The only fucking way I could get that video down is to sue that person. I actually have to file a legal lawsuit against that person. And if I gave that lawsuit to YouTube, YouTube would then take the video permanently down off the website. Now, for those of you who don't know,
so this is fair use then. He's admitting this. This video is fair use.
Individual lawsuit to create,
because I'm adding commentary to this
and have a video removed. That's actually the truth. It's not like, oh, it's like $20. No, it takes time and it's very expensive. Now, just think of all the people on YouTube who have stolen my videos and used them for their...
I'm not stealing this video because I'm on his channel right now. I'm part of the 1,300 views.
...to get those videos down unless I sue those people. Because YouTube will give them a copyright strike. But then that person, all they have to do is dispute the strike and say, well, I feel that it's fair use. And if they do that, it will be reinstated within 2 weeks unless I sue them directly. All right?
So...
Now...
So then at this
bad.
Point,
all right.
Pause one more time, sorry. If this was him, if this happened to him, let's say that this happened, he would probably be bitching and moaning about this. But, like, you know, if they change the system, because the way that YouTube works, I think is whatever. I mean, I think it's kind of shitty sometimes, but, you know, I know, because, like, he got a copyright strike, and he disputed it. If YouTube didn't give YouTubers that chance to dispute those claims, then that's fucking ridiculous. They should be able to appeal that. They should have that ability to, or that right to, because they have that right to explain themselves. If they didn't have that, Phil would probably, you know, be in a worse off position right now, because he'd probably say, well, YouTube didn't give me the opportunity to appeal them, or you know, whatever. It's ridiculous.
Pretty fucking bad is because there are some cases where you could say there's gray areas, right? But there's also cases where people can find ways to fuck with people's businesses. And a little
how is this fucking with your business?
I'm sorry, I don't make a
I'm literally like
and I don't have enough
listening to what you're saying and responding to it.
My content and abuses me in a negative light.
I'm not abusing you. You're doing it yourself, dude. I'm just saying stuff that you're saying. I'm just talking about what you're saying. It's there. How is this out of context? This is the full... Making jokes about Jewish people burning in an oven is racist. I'm sorry. That is awful. That's not even funny.
Video permanently unless you sue. I have confirmed this with YouTube. So even if they rip this video and just put it black and white, perfectly unedited on their page. I couldn't get that video permanently removed because they would just dispute my copyright claim, and I would have to sue them. So, literally right now, everyone could go to PewDiePie's page and download all the videos off his channel and upload them to their channel, and he could put copyright strikes against them, and they would just dispute them, and their channel would be back within a week or 2 weeks. And
2 weeks. Yours was given back within a week.
Everyone could steal everyone's content on YouTube unless you sue them. That's 100% true. Okay? Now, here's the flip side of it. How the flip side is terrible. Okay?
Oh, there's a flip side to this?
YouTube's copyright strike system is 100% automated. Okay?
Yeah, he's playing the victim on both sides of this coin, dude.
There's not a human eyeball that touches YouTube's copyright strike system. I've confirmed this with YouTube.
He confirmed it.
Here's what happens. You submit to YouTube a video, maybe one of my videos.
He probably got like an automated email, and that was confirmation enough for him.
Anyone on YouTube is susceptible to this. Submit a video. All you need.
I have a friend that works at Google. I should ask him. I should ask her about this.
Something in that video was kind of used before. So in the,
get an actual response from someone that works with Google.
How did this happen? You might ask yourself.
Again, I'm late. It's 1:30. I'm saying stuff.
How did this happen? Well, I had a few...
What? I guess Dream Chat, dude? Come on.
Pretending to be fans of mine. I don't really understand the situation.
I never pretend to be your fan. I don't...
Fan art to use fan-made
whatever. Oh, we're talking about fan art people.
In my videos. Legally, I had permission. It was posted on my forum.
Not really. I mean, the wording wasn't really official or legalized. Stuff like but,
that.
For whatever reason, splitting hairs.
Decided, well, months later, Phil fell for the trap. We gave him legal permission to use it. But
yes, Jackie Chin sat there and was like, he fell for my trap.
Any video, right?
No.
Where, let's say there was a person who made a bumper, so it's a little intro. They posted it to their YouTube channel.
Oh, he's talking about Jackie now.
In, let's say, March. Then they showed it to me in March. I really liked
dude,
it.
Dude,
so I used it in a video of mine because I had their legal permission to do it. Then they copyright stroke my account. YouTube...
Maybe because you're shitty
YouTube doesn't care
that you didn't do Project 7.
YouTube doesn't care if you have
and you took money from your fans.
It has an algorithm, an automated algorithm that looks at the facts.
Maybe it wasn't a trap to begin with.
It existed in March on this guy's channel, only on April on your channel. Well, he had precedent, so therefore copyright strike approved. And your account will get copyright strike. Again, no human reviews the situation. You could
but even if a human reviews that situation, it still seems like copyright infringement.
That completely phony information was entered into the copyright strikes, the false copyright strikes.
Dude, it almost sounds like he's about to cry.
In August. I'm not kidding
you. Not anymore, though.
The phone numbers were faked.
The
email addresses were fake. Completely bogus info. But no human works for YouTube that reviews the information. They just issue the fucking copyright strike like that. So just think about that. Again, how many YouTubers use thumbnails that are custom artwork that were submitted by fans? How many YouTubers? I know
a none.
YouTubers right now who have millions of subscribers, who have podcasts, that have introductions, fan art, and everything that are made by people who all they need to do is file a copyright strike against that channel, and that channel will get fucking shut down.
Nope.
Now, the good news is...
Mega64's thumbnails? I haven't seen a lot of fan-made thumbnails for them.
Those copyright strikes could never actually stand.
My thumbnails aren't fan-made. I made them.
Because
I just accept the thumbnail wherever YouTube picks. I don't care about my thumbnails as much. Someday I might, but not right now.
They posted it in March.
I was thinking of giving a shit, but...
Okay? So now I dispute it. The only way that that could stand, that copyright strike, is if that person went to a lawyer, spent hundreds of dollars, and sued me. If they sued me... Then YouTube would say, well, we got evidence of a lawsuit, therefore we throw our hands up, that video will stay down, and now it's between you two in court, hash it out. And that's the attitude that YouTube takes. Now, wait till you hear this, because this you will not believe. You will not fucking believe.
I will not believe this. Okay. Okay? Okay.
Here we go. Wait till you hear this.
How long do I have to wait, Phil? How long do I have to wait? So, come on.
I had a copyright strike placed against DSP Gaming in late August. It was for a piece of artwork that was owned by Nintendo. It was an official piece of Nintendo artwork that was used in a piece of fan art on a pre-stream. That's what it got stricken for, okay? That's actually what it got stricken for. And the person who claimed that they were the owner of the copyright put in their name as, like, oh, just the voice of truth or something like that.
The awesome one?
No. This person did not work for Nintendo. They didn't claim to work for Nintendo. But they claimed that they were the owner of the Nintendo fan art. Or, I'm sorry, the owner of the original piece of Nintendo art. And that this fan art had a...
But dude, Nintendo could see that and do that as well.
Right against me. So I was on a call with Machinima.
He was on a call, guys.
And I said, you have definitive proof in that copyright filing that's against the law, because this person does not work for Nintendo. They have no legal right to this artwork at all.
But, you know, we never heard about this before.
You know that it's wrong.
I realized that. Well, we never heard about this particular copyright strike. We've heard the one about Jackie Chan and Be Awesome one. But this one is new.
We are liable for 14 days. And just in case this person decides to file a lawsuit, even if that lawsuit may be frivolous, meaning it's a false lawsuit because they don't work for Nintendo, we still refuse to do anything because Google will not be sued. We refuse to be involved.
But if it's a false lawsuit, then there's really nothing to worry about.
A bunch of fucking
pussies. I don't know.
Yeah, they don't want to have any kind of right. They don't want to stick up for anyone who works for them. They don't want to stick up for anyone who puts content on YouTube.
But they gave you, like, a half your sentence of no streaming. You had to wait 2 weeks to give you 1 week.
The copyright strike process.
So they obviously didn't care about you, obviously.
YouTube is not only completely inefficient, it is not made for anyone who owns a copyright to actually take down anything. It is legally put in place to protect YouTube and Google only. Because the bottom line is, you don't need to take the video down. You could just sue right now. Like, right now.
But why would YouTube want to take that risk? I mean, it's not their...
against my will.
Like, yeah, it's on their website, but it's not their responsibility, because they have rules. You either follow them or you don't. So the people who didn't follow them, they have to be held accountable.
It's only there so YouTube...
Why should YouTube be involved?
And everyone could say, but it's inefficient and it doesn't work, because everyone could just dispute, and if there's no lawsuit, it's worthless, and YouTube will say, yeah, whatever, but we don't get sued, so it's okay. And I was told this to my face. I was told... yes, the system is only in place to protect Google and YouTube. We don't care about people who upload to our website.
Well, think about it. Imagine DSP opened a website, a YouTube, something to compete with YouTube, and people post, like, movies and, you know, other stuff, you know, whatever that would cause, that, you know, give copyright strikes. So would DSP really go out of his way of, like, Hey, this might be legit. Let's not get into a lawsuit. Let's not do this, okay, guys? Let's not do this, okay? It might be legit. No, because then he will go to court and then he's going to be shitty about it. No, it's not YouTube's responsibility to get involved with this matter, because it's between the person who flagged and the person who uploaded the video. That's how it works. It's not... person who flagged YouTube, Phil, because YouTube has a terms of service. That's the whole point of terms of services. Because it says, if you do this, you're breaking our rules, and we're not going to, you know, help you because we have these rules here for a reason.
And I was like, wow.
Come on, Phil.
That is really amazing.
That's amazing.
That a business, YouTube, right? This is a business that the only reason YouTube ever made a dollar is because hardworking, talented people, me and how many millions of other people, put their creative content...
I put more effort than he does, to be honest. You know, that might sound like shit, but I do.
On our content,
I watch some of his vids, and it's not really that.
Fuck about any of us. They literally told me that.
I showed you my storyboards. Show me his script for Project 7.
Alright. Now, I see some comments in the stream chat that I will address.
Okay, let's address the stream chat.
Well, someone is saying,
did they pay for this?
Phil is lazy. He needs to submit copyright strikes against people that use his videos. Once the channels start getting shut down after 3 strikes, you know damn well that they'll stop stealing your content. Wrong. Because I just explained, when anyone files a copyright strike on YouTube, it doesn't stand unless you sue the person. So let's say, for example, there is a person on YouTube that used my content illegally. Which I've confirmed with a lawyer now, by the way.
By the way.
I would have to submit 3 lawsuits against them. So now we're talking
three. Whoa. He went from one to three.
Three lawsuits to get it to stick. If I just do copyright strikes, and even if the channel gets shut down temporarily, all they need to do is dispute it. Because again, there's no human interaction here. It's all an automated system. They dispute it, and that's it. After 2 weeks, their channel comes back. And all their videos come back, including the one that I put the copyright strikes against. So that's not true. There's no way for that to work.
No way.
And I can tell you, I've tried it. And older people have tried it. Because I've been in cahoots, not cahoots, but in communication is what I meant to say.
He took down a video from Loophole. He took it down. He took it down. Is that you don't play Minecraft? He took that video down.
Doesn't work. Come back because I didn't sue them and spend thousands of dollars out of my own pocket.
Of course they will come back because you make it easy for them to come back.
YouTube doesn't care.
If you don't see shit.
They say unless you're going to spend thousands of dollars out of your own pocket to take down a channel. Here's the thing, right? Ultimately, let's talk turkey here.
Let's talk turkey.
The majority of people who steal content from me
are haters.
And do defamatory things about me.
Defamatory.
Our little rinky-dink channels. Wow, they've got 5,000 views. Big fucking deal, right? Now, there are some exceptions. There were a few videos playing certain games that went viral.
Apparently, this channel is a little rinky-dink because there's only, like, you know, 7 subscribers. But this is branching off of my original channel, Theo Does Videos. Please check that channel out. I like that channel a lot. It has a lot of good content on it. I'm really... there's a little self-plug right here, but, you know, I got replied to a comment that I posted on Phil's channel a long time ago, and someone said, well, all you do is upload videos to DSP, and at that time, I had 2 or 3 DSP videos to my 100-something videos of non-DSP related stuff. So you tell me what outweighs what. Does the DSP stuff outweigh the 100 plus videos that are not DSP or the 3 little videos that I did? And yeah, I decided to open a channel for DSP videos because I didn't want that channel to be tainted with DSP stuff because I figured my initial subscribers on that channel did not subscribe for this. They subscribed for, you know, my art videos that I do and all that kind of stuff, so I didn't want to do that. So I made this channel for this reason. So yeah, this channel is definitely going to be DSP only stuff here, but this is like a companion channel to my channel. So that's why I have this channel. So yeah, I guess I'm a little rinky-dink person. I don't know. Yeah, I don't have millions of views.
I do fully believe.
The highest I've seen my DSP videos go up to is like 300, 350 something.
Ultimately. Every little video that comes out there, you know, is not going to hurt me. And I don't have the money. I don't have the
This video will not hurt him, but he'll definitely get upset about other haters.
A viral funny thing to make fun of me, right? I couldn't take these people to court. You know?
But I thought it won't hurt you though.
I have no defense against this at all. Over the years people have said
But this won't hurt you though. You just said this wouldn't hurt you.
I tried with a few people and their channels came back after 2 weeks. And basically they said, neener. Here's the bottom line. Here's why it doesn't work. Because those people come back and they say, ha-ha, see? We were proven right. Our videos are fair use because YouTube restored the content. And that's not true at all. That's actually not true at all. YouTube is not saying that content is protected under fair use. YouTube is saying, well, there was no lawsuit filed, so we have no legal liability.
So I guess that's why he got his channel back, guys.
Well, we have no responsibility to do anything about this.
So there you go.
The entire copyright system on YouTube is anti-uploader.
Anti-uploader.
It's only to protect YouTube.
YouTube is a detractor. No one is safe.
There is an exception.
Oh, but there is an exception now.
There is an exception. There is an elite upper class on YouTube. And this is not, again, this is not
elite upper class. How many, what?
This is not an exaggeration. I got this from the mouth of Machinima Management and YouTube Management.
He gets a lot of stuff from them. Apparently, they had like late nights with each other.
People who have millions upon millions of subscribers who make YouTube big money because they are draws. Of course, yes, I'm talking about PewDiePie, and yes, I'm talking about the biggest YouTubers out there. You know the YouTubers that YouTube promotes, like Shane Dawson and iJustine. You see YouTube actually having ads with them on subways and shit.
Oh, iJustine.
Yeah, those YouTubers have been put under a protected status by YouTube.
Protective status.
YouTubers cannot receive copyright strikes. because YouTube put them under protective status. If you try to strike those accounts, they'll actually get blocked and say, no, you need to file a lawsuit first. But it's an elite upper class that YouTube has hand-selected to be a part. And when I was going
to... It sounds like a fucking...
In August, my channel being shut down.
Can't think of it now.
Streaming being shut down temporarily in August. I spoke to Machinima about it.
Shit.
And I said...
It sounds like the Patriots are behind this. Safer, man.
We have a few
Safer sees all.
Who are protected. But we very much doubt that YouTube would put you under that status because you don't qualify. You don't bring in millions of views a day. And you don't have millions of subscribers. So you're not part of the elite class. And because you're not part of the elite class, you're basically fucked, and you're subject
fucked.
To get these copyright issues against you all the time.
How far are we in
and
this?
I said, well, that makes me feel great. You know,
we're almost done, guys. We're almost done.
When
Man.
Let's Plays on YouTube were not popular.
Man.
They were not. It was all video
this
game
video, This video is something.
And I was one of the very few people who started talking and doing live commentary of raw, unedited playthroughs, and I was part of the phenomenon that made those playthroughs popular on YouTube. No, I was not the originator, but I was one of the originators, okay?
One of the founding fathers of Let's Plays.
I was very hard-headed, and I was stubborn, and I didn't want to change in a lot of ways.
You're still stubborn, and you're still hard-headed, and you're very irrational, dude.
I wanted to make it. I didn't sell out. I didn't go and find someone to do happy, you know, big high-level video editing for me, and I didn't partner with giant corporation who said.
And he doesn't edit his videos, and he doesn't do Project 7, and he doesn't listen
to
fan feedback.
And people have now who were inspired by me, people who because they saw my content on YouTube, have gone on to have millions of subscribers and make millions of dollars, right? And I'm the one that gets fucked. The originator, one of the originators
Dude,
started this whole thing.
I'm fucking him over. My minuscule views that I make zero money on, I'm fucking him over. I'm taking all his money by not getting any money. No, this is dumb. In case someone's going to comment, no, these are not monetized vids. I would never do that. I would never do that.
Isn't
but
good enough.
Now I'm probably going to cast some disbelief there.
But
they're
the big dogs, right? And that's YouTube's mentality. And that's just
YouTube's mentality.
Insane. And it just, it does. It baffles, it doesn't just baffle me. It like, it's disheartening. It's disheartening for anyone.
Disheartening,
on YouTube.
Dude.
Oh, so now there's an elite upper class who's protected from everything. Yeah, it's true. Just like in life, there's protected upper classes who don't go to jail, who don't get sued because they have the money.
Real world
it's
YouTube.
It's fucking disgusting. And it's, when I started on YouTube, it was nothing like that at all. YouTube was like, everyone had an equal level, right? To become popular,
it's climbers.
And now you've got the protected upper class. Just like real life, now you've got the protected upper class of YouTube, and, you know, it's a joke, and it pisses me the fuck off. It really does.
It really does. Look at the stream chat.
And, I just don't know. It really frustrates me, and that is the truth about the YouTube copyright system. Completely to protect YouTube, completely anti-user or content creator. You cannot shut down anyone's channel permanently, ever, unless you sue them and pay money to do it. Everyone is liable for false copyright claims because YouTube system is completely automated. I'll tell you right now, I'm not joking you. Any YouTuber who's not in that protected upper class, you could file false copyright claims against them for things like thumbnails, for video intros, anything. You could do it and they will get taken down. Now, they'll only be temporary because they will file counterclaims. The channel will be up in 2 weeks, but you could do it to anyone. So literally 100% of the content that you upload to your channel has to be yours and yours alone. Which is why on DSP Gaming, I can no longer upload any thumbnails. I can no longer upload any intros. There will be no more pre-streams with fan art. I just can't do it anymore. I can't
have custom thumbnails. You just have to put effort in them, Phil.
It's just
you could
it's
look, okay, Phil, I'll give you a freebie here. I'll give you a free little tip. You could take a gameplay screenshot from your playthrough, you queue at the DSP watermark, and then you take a picture of your face, and then you put your face on the picture, like, and then you upload that as your custom thumbnail. There you go. Or you take your channel thumbnail that you have on your DSP gaming, you wearing a Sonic hat. And put it there, and put the game cover, like, right there, or something. You can do that. There's my freebie for you, Phil. You can definitely have custom thumbnails and custom everything. It might take you a few minutes, but you could do it. If a 9-year-old could do it, you could do it, Phil. I have complete faith in you. I have complete faith, Phil. You can take pictures. You can do stuff. You don't need a big lens camera that does 1080p and 60 frames to take a picture. You could even take your phone and take a picture and put it there. There you go, Phil. I gave you some nice little tips. And if you do that, if you do those tips, if you do that, if I see them on your channel, then I will definitely say you listen to your fans sometimes, but I don't think you're going to do it, Phil. But there's some freebies for you. There's a freebie idea.
Gross. And I completely hate it, but this is kind of the reality of what I do. There's a trade-off, right? I get to play video games for a living. I get to have fun daily and share those fun and exciting experiences with you. And that's a great thing. I own an awesome house.
Yeah,
I
live sure.
with my girlfriend.
It's a great thing.
You know,
it's fan service, dude.
Thing.
Even though you get
my
paid
job,
for it.
I wouldn't want to do anything else but this for my job. If I
obviously, you don't want to do anything else. To me, it's so clear.
I have to deal with this bullshit.
Have to deal with this bullshit.
It's sad. It really is sad. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's it for Hate. What a downer to end Hate Live on.
Oh my God, thank God.
Even with all that negative shit we just talked about, I'm feeling positive. We've got great games coming out this next week. I'm looking forward to the end game of Metal Gear Solid 5. I'm looking forward to finishing Fallout New Vegas.
I'm not really thinking about the ending. I wonder.
Trying out Soma this week. I'm very much looking forward to...
Sorry, I yawned.
All the new games coming out for the rest of this hardcore gaming season.
Dude, it's 2 o'clock. Ugh.
I am very much looking forward to...
I started this at like 12.
Incredibly
this is going to be a 3-hour video.
On a daily basis, regardless of this bullshit.
I'm so sorry. I'm sorry, my viewers. You've sat through 3 hours of this.
I wouldn't give it up.
Oh my God.
Daily, I get messages from people who say thank you so much.
God. This is awful. This is torture.
Something positive, and we
I wouldn't see a 3-hour video. I can't believe I'm making a 3-hour video of this.
DOS, swatted.
God, dude.
Impersonating me. Fucking, this is how you don't play nonsense. Every negative possible.
He named his stream, this is how you don't play.
I refuse and, to quit. I'll put up with all.
Look, Phil, I don't want you to quit, but I want you to say less bullshit. How about that? How about that?
Swatted because of the bullshit that happens to us. It's unfair, but you know what? I'm not going to give up because then they win. Those motherfuckers win if I quit. I'm not going to ever quit. Every little thing that they do to me makes me stronger. It makes me more fucking dedicated to doing this.
It doesn't make them stronger. It makes it.
I don't understand
it more
how they realize that. My mantra or my nickname is the King of Hate because I take all this negativity and I use it to fuel me to become.
Dude, he gets so
why
salty.
The fuck do you think that doing all
so
this stuff
fast.
Makes me stop. It makes me stronger.
No, it doesn't.
It
makes you look so salty.
It makes me more fucking motivated.
You want to be motivated, but you're never motivated.
Make this work. So why the fuck?
This is like a demotivator, if anything. Like, watching, like, I was, like, in the morning, like, I did stuff, and then I studied for an exam. Then I was like, whoa, dude, I want to do some art stuff, because I really want to. I was fueled. And now I'm watching this, and I feel demotivated. Like,
thank you for a great episode of
Oh my God, this is the worst episode. This is the worst episode, dude.
Oh, great.
Like, I saw another Hate Live, like, last one I saw, and it was like, okay, it was something, it was, but this is awful.
I don't know if there'll be an episode of Hate Live next week because of Soma. I'll see,
good.
If not, there will definitely
no
be
more.
Another one coming up at some point
no more.
In the next few weeks. I'll just let you know.
This is torture.
I gotta go.
Whoever's watching this for
thanks
3 hours,
peace out,
I'm sorry I'm torturing you too. I'm sorry.
I have to fucking give myself the high.
If you're watching this, I'm gonna put something here that's gonna, like, I don't know. Oh my God, I sat through 2 hours of this. This is awful. Okay. You know what? I talked enough. Thanks for watching this video. I don't know what else. I'm probably gonna take another break from Phil after this. So just stay tuned. Just go to my Theodas Videos channel. Subscribe to that channel. Watch those videos. Those videos are good. Actually, you know, we're gonna go on a field trip. I don't want to end on this Debbie Downer. Okay, so let's go to my channel. Let's find a video on my channel that we like. Okay, like that. Or that I want to see, you know? There's some reviews. You can watch some of my reviews here. This is kind of a self-plug right here. There's a little prize if you stick through this. You know what? Let's watch. Okay. DSP video update. No, I don't want to do that. Let's see. Yeah, let's do a ton of them. Yeah, you know what? Hold on. Wait a second. This one I feel like someone got really salty in. Okay, you're gonna watch this one, right? Fukua and Eliza versus Fortune and Valentine and Eliza, so it's a mirror match in this one. Let's watch this. I like this game. If you wanna fight me, that's my name right there, Giant Enemy Crap. So feel free to add me. I have Second Encore, and I have the PSD version as well, but I'm mostly playing on Second Encore, obviously. So, yeah, if you want to fight me on Skullgirls, feel free to add me and let me know, because it might be fun. But no peacocks. That's my only rule. No peacocks. There you go. So let's watch this.
Beat him up, guys!
I'm Fuku and Eliza, by the way. I like the music. Now it's personal. This is the Raggio skin of Eliza. She's seen Kill a Kill, you know what that is. I feel like she glides, like, in a slide forward. She's supposed to be happy again. I wish that hit. Oh! That hit. Oh, Sekhmet, you're the best. Axe. Oh, no. I know this guy was really excited. I bet he thought he was gonna win this one. There you go.
I guess we won.
So close.
That was close. All right, now I feel a little bit better. I feel a little bit better after watching that. That was your little gift if you stuck around this 3-hour long video nonsense. Subscribe to this channel. This channel is a lot better than this channel. I'm working on a video series that I was kind of late on, but I'm still working on that. Don't worry. You're going to see it soon. You're going to see it sometime. But thanks for watching this video, guys. I really appreciate you watching this. I really, really do. But this video has been going on for way too long. So thanks for watching. I'm going to end it here. See you in the next video.